and welcome on this beautiful sunny Johannesburg morning. And thank you very much for making the effort to come here. We're absolutely overwhelmed by the fullness and the buzz of expectation and excitement around this meeting. I suppose I should start by introducing ICTSD and myself, because we're perhaps not quite that well known in this area. For those of you who don't know us, ICTSD is what we like to call ourselves, as a sort of a think and do tank based out of Geneva, Switzerland, but with global reach and very much global activity and global cognizance. Our mission is about sustainable development, but we operate solidly within the realm of trade policy, trade negotiations, and understanding and trying to promote and utilize the role of trade policy and trade negotiations in promoting sustainable development. It is no coincidence that we were founded nearly 20 years ago now, more or less in concatenation with the founding of the WTO. And I remember myself, I was working for the UN at that time, but also in Geneva, and at that time, the WTO was this really incredible black box. And even as a UN rep, I didn't get full access to negotiations and discussions there. And so what the ICTSD did back in those times was understand the need for transparency in promoting sustainable development and in promoting understanding and in gaining sort of engagement through multiple stakeholders. Now, of course, 20 years on, not only is the WTO a very, very different place and very much more open, but in fact, the world has moved on, and trade policy and trade discussion and trade negotiation proliferates in so very many other places. We've seen this overwhelming proliferation of regional trade agreements and bilateral trade arrangements. And really now we see, and ICTSD has grown and continued to engage in bringing together multiple groups of stakeholders and really seeing how and promoting that bringing some knowledge, bringing some ideas, and bringing people together is what really makes for advancement in understanding opportunities, and understanding challenges and overcoming those challenges. So what we really bring to the table that is sometimes that little bit different is really this open discussion amongst multiple stakeholders based on different perspectives and different understandings. So very much then, of course, is the issue of we are here with our partners, the SAIIA, who is probably very much better known to everybody here, and Tedrigo will probably make some introduction to, about SAIIA in a few minutes. But why do we partner with SAIIA? Firstly, we partner with SAIIA because we partner. This is what ICTSD does. We work with people in relevant places to grow stakeholder groups, to grow constituencies. And we try to look for the people that are best respected and best known and of the highest quality on the ground. And unarguably, SAIIA is probably the most respected think tank in the continent, and therefore we partner with SAIIA here. But I won't say more about that now. I'd just very briefly like to introduce myself and our team here today. I'm Deborah Voorhees, and I'm the Managing Director at ICTSD. We have here Darlington Wapi. Ambassador Wapi is our Senior Fellow for Africa, our Senior Development Economist and Manager of our Development Program. Vina Anchuraz is over here. Kiran, who manages this particular project on regional integration. And Joanita, who is sitting over there. And darling Joanita is your go-to and problem solver. Anybody has any issue at all, go to Joanita. So why are we here? What are we doing here? I mentioned very briefly this proliferation and this understanding we have about how trade policy not only happens at the national level, of course, and subnational levels, and at the multinational level in Geneva, but also at regional and in bilateral processes. This is particularly important in Africa right now. We've seen over time the creation of, and being able to talk more about how this has evolved and where we are with this, I won't preempt him too much, through SADC, COMESA, SADC, EAC, etc., etc., etc. But we saw quite a milestone in June with the signing of the TFTA. And we see also the commencement of the CFTA negotiations. So we really exercised about what does this mean? How do these things all fit together? And how do they come together to make opportunities? We're also not leaving behind some existing arrangements. We're looking at AGOA, we're looking at the EPAs, and what that means in this fast-evolving context. And equally importantly, we're looking at the relationship between African countries and the emerging economies. What happens with the relationships with India, with China? Looking at how fast the dynamics move. I mean, the news this morning is that the stock exchange in Beijing is plunged by some horrendous fear. What does this mean? Is this relevant for us? We understand, as Darlington was telling me, about the problems with the steel industry, with ArcelorMittal, which is a traditional Indian investor here. These things just move so fast in Africa. We have to keep on top of the game. We have to be understanding constantly where things are moving and try to enhance understanding. Of course, there's also the Financing for Development meeting that was finished a couple of weeks ago, which came out with a statement which clearly understood and reflected how trade is important for economic growth and for the achievement of sustainable development goals in Africa. And that's another context in which we work. More broadly speaking, however, for ICTSD, we see this meeting as part of a series of meetings and a growth of understanding and stakeholder engagement throughout Africa. We hope to go forward with another meeting in Nairobi in September. We'll be understanding and trying to look towards West Africa as well next year. And we're seeing this as the first conversation. It's just a conversation today of bringing some ideas and sharing some ideas and perspectives and views. And we'll try to, this is not a negotiating place. We are here to talk, to try to understand each other. And we will try to, out of this, together with our partners, see how to take these conversations, these thoughts forward in a program of research if required and in a program of further dialogues. So we do urge you to be as open as possible in discussion, knowing that there will be future discussions in Nairobi, in West Africa, most importantly, of course, also in Nairobi at the end of the year in December. In December, as we know, the WTO will have its 10th ministerial conference in Nairobi. And, of course, to us, very importantly, we will be hosting the Trade and Development Symposium, and there's some of these outside. If anybody's interested, come and talk to me about it. ICTSD does this at every ministerial conference, understanding that, firstly, there are issues that are of importance in terms of trade policy, trade discussion, and trade in relation to development and sustainable development that goes beyond the specific confines of the ministerial agenda, for example, regional issues, for example, broader issues. And also, we understand that there's a discussion and a consideration to be had among a broader group of stakeholders, whether that be business, academia, domestic constituencies, other constituencies, civil society, that goes beyond the narrow confines of the WTO negotiations. So we typically, at every ministerial conference, have a trade and development symposium where we provide a platform for anybody and everybody to come and talk about the issues. So as I said, I'm available to discuss this. There's a brochure here. If you're interested in coming and being part of that or attending it, just let me know. Furthermore, of course, this is a year that we see as a year of sort of international policy coherence. It is a year in which the Sustainable Development Goals will be agreed, hopefully, in New York in September. We go from there to quite a sea change here in the climate discussions as well, in Paris at the end of November, early December. And it culminates in Nairobi in December. And we're seeing quite a special year for people and governments and other constituencies and stakeholders being sort of drawn to thinking more broadly, to bringing these issues together. Where does trade and trade policy fit with sustainable development? It's a year of focus around that. And we are hoping that in this series of meetings, we will provide a platform for future engagement over the next few years, where we can really see how
we can join together to make a contribution to sustainable and inclusive growth in Africa. So that's what this meeting really is about. Very briefly, I would just like to talk to a few housekeeping issues. This meeting is a discussion. It's an open conversation. It is being webcast to, well, load shedding permitting, of course. It is being webcast to the whole world. Please feel free to tweet, to encourage people to tune in, to send in questions if they want in the discussion areas. But you do need to be aware that what you say is part of an open conversation. This is not a narrow confine. Furthermore, there may be press coming in and out, and you may be asked for a few words at some point in the breaks or anything. Just feel free, you know, be warned, you may be approached, you may not be approached, but don't be taken completely by surprise if that should happen. Hopal, is Hopal here? Hopal's over here, he comes for SAIIA, and he is convening and managing our press interaction. So if you have any questions, please talk to Hopal. I'm just absolving myself of responsibility. The dinner tonight is a conversation dinner yet again, and I just want to talk to that for a brief minute. We're not going to give you too long off after the meeting this evening. You can have about half an hour free to do your emails and phone calls, and then we'll have drinks and we'll go into dinner. What we're asking you to do at dinner is each table will be given a question. And the question is an issue that is of import to Africa. It is a challenge we face. And we ask you as a table to just chat about it for a while and think about it. It's a little bit broader than what we're talking about in the meeting. So it might be climate change, for example, or access to energy or something. And then after the main course, we're going to ask each table to come and give a little five-minute response to that question, just to have a bit of fun and to let our minds roam a bit more broadly. I just wanted to warn you about that as well. I think I've pretty much covered all the introductory bits and pieces from our perspective now. What I'd like to do is ask everybody in turn just to spend no more than 20 seconds introducing themselves, including the overflow people over there, please. We've had a great turnout to this meeting. And then I'll hand over to Jolie Mo to moderate the first session. So, Jolie.
Thank you very much, and good morning, everyone. My name is Jolie Keane. I'm an economic advisor with the Commonwealth Secretariat based in London.
My name, as introduced, Darlington Mwate. I'm a senior fellow at ICTSD.
Nigel Quinnen, at the Department of Trade and Industry in South Africa, and dealing with African industrial development.
Good morning. My name is Charles Moran, trade negotiator from the Ministry of Finance, Trade and Agro Economy of Seychelles. Thank you.
My name is John Banda. I come from Malawi. I run my company, JJ Enterprise, based in agribusiness.
Morning, everyone. My name is Rachel Kemekisha from the Commerce Secretariat. I work as a trade advisor. Thank you.
Good morning. I'm Eric Ramsey from GMED. I'm the CEO of the Economic Development Board of Madagascar.
Good morning. I'm Tuto Matiza. I'm a consultant from Lesotho. I also work for the Lesotho Revenue Authority.
Good morning. My name is Baba Jileshuripa. I'm the Regional Trade Advisor with the African Union Commission.
Morning. My name is Mpoma Supa. I'm from Lesotho, from the Ministry of Trade and Industry.
Hi, my name is Yuvan Naidu. I'm with Barclays Africa.
Good morning. My name is Jeffrey Sakulanda from Zambia. I head the National Chamber of Commerce and Industry.
Good morning. I'm Walidu. I'm from the Namibia Agricultural Union. I'm the head of research, and my involvement in trade policy stretches about 17 years.
Good morning. I'm David Shasimamata. I work the Regional Division Division of the Ministry of Foreign Affairs in the Regional Division in International Trade Relations.
Good morning, my name is Alan Fonse. I am in the media industry in Seychelles. I've got my own media house. I'm here to represent the Seychelles Chamber of Commerce and Industry. Thank you.
Good Pearson. I'm an independent consultant. I'm also an associate of the Brain Trust Foundation, but whatever I say is not representing the Brain Trust Foundation, I'm just an associate.
My name's Asana
Good morning, everyone. My name is Bonisi Wendando. I'm the CEO of the Chamber of Commerce in Swaziland.
Good morning. My name is Hastings from Ministry of Trade.
Good morning. My name is Farola Khan. I represent the Swiss Chamber of Commerce and Industry.
Good morning, everyone. Mohana from the Swiss Chamber of Commerce and Industry.
My name is Dishaba Mrobe. I'm with the Botswana Confederation of Commerce. I'm responsible for policy advocacy. Thank you.
Good morning. My name is Kasidu Racha. I'm from the SADC Secretariat. I work at the Trade and Trade Industry Finance and Investment Directorate.
My name is
Penny
Ambeko Kapofi. I'm from Namibia Customs and Excise.
Good morning.
My name is Lewandi Abulapeko. I'm a senior research associate at the Trade Collective, which deals with international trade and regional integration, and I'm also an associate of University of South Africa.
I'm Felix Mutache, Member of Parliament from Zambia and former Minister of Trade.
Hello, Vinay Acharas from the ICTSD. I'm a senior economist there and I manage the development program.
Could we, sorry, before to Jerima, could we just, everybody else that we've missed, could you just stand up and introduce yourselves, please? You may have to bellow if you don't have a
heart. Leslie Wentworth, the Program Manager for Economic Diplomacy at SAIIA.
I'm hopeful that I'm helping you with the media.
Hi, I'm Christopher Wood. I'm a researcher in economic policy at SAIIA.
Good morning, I'm Mark Skoman. I'm a researcher in the Economic Diplomacy Program at SAIIA.
And morning, I'm Rena Josh McCormick. I'm at SAIIA Communications.
And we have one more person coming.
Okay, I wouldn't want to sort of candidate just like this morning. My name is Agunias Masia from Mozambique, Minister of International Trade Policy Analyst. Thank
you. Could I just ask you all please to speak quite closely to the mic, just so that you can be well picked up for the webcast for our benefit?
I'm Shuri Mohengari, senior fellow at SAIIA. thank you very much for co-hosting this conversation with us. For us, it's also a pleasure to be associating with what is really a first-class institution. When I was requested to stand in for my colleague, Noema Khobler-Apuwe, as some other pressing engagement in Cape Town, I looked at the program, and one of the things that I found remarkable was the optimistic tone of the program, because I mostly work on what international relations scholars refer to as high politics. So for the past 2 weeks, I've been commenting on Burundi, Nigeria, and this is all pessimistic stuff. So I think I'm very, really pleased to be here to talk about a very optimistic picture for Africa. My role is very simple, essentially to moderate this conversation, and I can see that we are slightly running out of time. So I'll first call on Vinay Asharaz to talk to African integration facing up to emerging challenges, and then Jody King will come in as well and make a presentation. I understand the presentations are not longer than 20 minutes, and these presentations will be followed by discussions. I don't see Palisa here, but I do see Magda Wakane. So first the presentations and then the discussions. Who can come in with a few remarks, and then we'll open up the conversation for a broader Q&A. Rene, the floor is yours, please.
Thank you, Chair. Honorable MD, ladies and gentlemen, colleagues, it's a pleasure to be here this morning. My presentation really is like a scene setter. We are going to cover in this dialogue a number of issues, as you can see from the agenda. And what I want to do in this, in the next 20 minutes, is really to give you a sort of broad brush picture of where we are in terms of regional integration, what the challenges are, what are the opportunities as well. As you know, this is an important year for regional integration on the continent. The TFTA was launched in June. The talks on the CFTA, the continental FTA, were also launched just about a week later. And all this, I think, is raising a number of questions probably in our minds, which I would summarize in terms of where are we headed? Where are we headed, especially at a time when the global setting there are so many issues happening out there, which in one way or another would impact on the regional integration process. And I'm going to sort of very briefly talk about some of those issues. Actually, the presentation is very long. If I were to really do justice to it, you will have to give me a whole hour, Chair. But obviously, I don't want to monopolize the time. I will try to be very short, brief. You will have a chance to look at the presentation later. I will just flag some of the issues that I think are important. So a number of challenges on the horizon. A number of challenges happening right now, and we are facing those challenges. We are talking about the mega regionals. We are talking about some positive in terms of opportunities, therefore, and then obviously challenges as well. You can see, depending on how you see it. For some people, a challenge is, the flip side of it is an opportunity. We have the EPAs which have been concluded. How do you see that? Is that a challenge or is it an opportunity? You have AGOA, which was renewed just recently. Okay, what is it? If you look at the track record of African countries benefiting from AGOA, well, I'm saying benefiting, but as you know, many countries have not been able to really benefit from it. Some countries have. Lesotho, I think, is one good example of a country which has been able to build a vibrant, I should say, textile industry based on its access to the American market. Mauritius, to some extent as well. Some other countries, Madagascar. So now you have AGOA, which has been extended for another 10 years. What does that mean? It's an opportunity, obviously, but it's also a challenge for some of the other countries that have not been able to benefit from AGOA up till now. And why are we still so much into textiles when it comes to AGOA? Why aren't we able to go beyond textiles? South Africa, I think, is doing a bit better. They are able to sort of export autos to the US. But what about some of the other countries? Can we think beyond textiles? Okay, how can we really leverage AGOA? What does that mean for trade in the region, for the region, and within the region as well?
So a number of those issues, the TFA, the Trade Facilitation Agreement, trade facilitation is a major issue for Africa. Many of countries, I think 15 countries in Africa are landlocked countries, okay? And trade facilitation is critically needed in those countries. We have an agreement out there, but we see a bit of resistance in countries to really take up and implement the agreement. What does that mean? What will it mean for regional integration and all that? So anyway, let me start with this very quickly. I just hope I have to use this one. Okay, here we are. I'm sorry for those who are sitting close to the PowerPoint. You'll probably have to sort of turn a bit. Okay. Very quickly, I just want to talk about where we stand right now. Where did we come from? Obviously, we have come a long way, starting from the Abuja Treaty to the launch of the TFTA, and we have even more ambitious sort of milestones that are there. What is the current state of regional integration? And here I'm going to use some data to show to you really what is the extent of intra-regional trade in Africa, and probably some of the numbers will surprise you. And then talk about the challenges and opportunities very quickly. Okay, so the Abuja Treaty, which was signed in 1991 and which really become effective in 1994, it envisages the establishment of what we call an African Economic Community over six phases and over 34 years by 2028. Where are we when it comes to implementing the Abuja Treaty? Well, it appears that we are largely on target. Even if there has been some delay at the level of the ranks. So you have this chart that really summarizes what has happened over the years. I won't have time to really go over it in detail. But just to give you an example, if you look at, so you have those six stages. If you were to look at, for example, stage three, the third stage, which basically envisages the establishment of FTAs and customs union at the REC level. Well, a number of countries already have, a number of RECs already with an FTA, ongoing FTA. Some of them, the EAC, for example, has gone beyond that. Okay, you have a customs union, they have even launched a common market. Okay. Some other RECs, like COMESA, launch a customs union as well, even though there are some issues there. So ECOWAS, so we have gone, many of the RECs have gone beyond an FTA. The only one that has unfortunately still stuck with an FTA is SADC, where we are sitting here today. So if you look at this milestone, I would say we have largely met it. Okay? Many of the RECs have gone beyond an FTA. So in this way, really, when you look at the Abuja Treaty, we are largely on target. Okay, where we actually have problems, it's here actually, at the level of the RECs. Okay, and this chart summarizes basically what the ambition was and where and I would just say a word about where we are. Just to give you an example, if you were to look at the last row there, which is SADC. Okay, the ambition was to have an FTA by 2008. Okay, we have it. The ambition was to have a customs union by 2010, to have a common market by 2015, to have a monetary union in 2016. We are in 2015 today, and we are far from a customs union. Okay, so that tells you really the delays have been at the level of the ranks. And you have similar issues in other countries as well. I think the only one which has made quite a bit of progress is the EAC. The COMESA has been grappling with its customs union, its common external tariff for some time now. Now, the question that this raises is, and this is something that I want to just flag, is now that we are talking about a TFTA, a tripartite FTA, the fact that you have three RECs which have merged to launch this TFTA, we have COMESA, which is
at more than an FTA. Okay, I won't say it's fully a customs union. Maybe some people will disagree. It has a common external tariff, but there are some issues. You have the EAC, which is beyond a customs union. It has gone beyond. I think they have even launched talks about a monetary union now. You have SADC, which is still an FTA. So you have three ranks with different levels of achievement in terms of progress. Now, when you take the three together into a TFTA, does that mean a leveling out at the bottom? Meaning, what is it? What does that mean? Is it that the FTA, is it the lowest common denominator that prevails? Because we can't think of the TFTA as ultimately a customs union. Obviously, that is not the idea. Okay, but will it be what the name says it is, just an FTA? That is the question. Is it, this is what I call a lowest common denominator. So to look at the current state of integration, we have computed what we call trade intensity indices. So if you look at this, obviously the EAC stands out as the best performing of the Forex. We are looking at Forex here. We can obviously do this for more, but I think these are the main ones in Africa. The EAC, which over the past 5 years actually has an average trade intensity of 17%, followed by SADC with 13%. And you can see ECOWAS and COMESA are far below, about 5%, less than 6% actually. So these are very low, in my view at least, very low levels of intra-industry, intra-regional trade, especially when you compare with some of the other regional blocs around the world, okay, which we can take as an example. For example, if you were to compare with ASEAN, which is one of the better performing RECs in the world, ASEAN has an export intensity index of 26% in 2011. 26%. Even the best African REC, which is the EAC, is far below that. Okay, so really, when it comes to, well, of course, you might say that you can't summarize regional integration in terms of index. Yes, I agree. Okay, you have this dimension of regional cooperation, which has been a key driver of regional integration in Africa, perhaps more than in other RECs around the world. But yeah, I mean, trade remains, trade is probably one of the things that that is measurable, okay? And it remains a key measure, a key indicator of the degree of integration. And on that account, we see that we are not really doing very well. In terms of intra-regional trade, you have two graphs here. The one on your left is intra-Africa trade, so that's for the continent as a whole. The one on your right is for the TFTA. And the way we generated this graph, the TFTA graph, is basically by adding together the countries that make up the TFTA. One thing I just want to point out, well, one positive thing is, obviously, you see the curve going up, which is very nice. You have a very, so basically intra-exports, intra-regional trade has been increasing and quite rapidly, I would say. We see, especially if you look at the left-hand side chart, you see the dominance of South Africa there. Okay. South Africa accounts for over 50% of intra-TFTA trade, intra-Africa trade as well. If you just take away South Africa, you're left with very low levels of intra-regional trade. And here I have the trade intensity indices for Africa as a whole and for TFTA. Again, over the years, you can see quite a bit of variation, especially in the years 2007, 2008, with sharp decline. But then they have both trends have picked up. So again here you see that for the TFTA on average it has been about 10%, for Africa a bit less. Again, if you were to compare these numbers, now that we are comparing at the level, at a bigger, at a broader regional level, so if you look at Africa, for example, the trade intensity less than 10%, how does that compare with some of the other regions? Just to give you an example, if you were to look at intra-Asia trade, okay, intra-Asia trade is about 52% compared to intra-Africa trade of just less than 10%. That tells you really how far behind we are. If you look at EU as a region, okay, intra-EU trade is 63%. Okay, we are far behind. If you look at South America, Latin America, okay, a less performing, I mean, much less of a, performer compared to the other regions. But even then, in intra-regional trade is about 27%. So we have a lot of ground to make up. Now, the positive story really is when it comes to investment analysis. And this is one thing that is usually missed in analysis of regional integration, because we tend to focus on trade, okay? But when you look at, and this is another dimension of regional integration, this is what I call intra-regional investment flows, or cross-border FDI flows. And you see, if you were to look at, I'm focusing obviously over these three rights, you can see significant increases in intra-REC FDI flows, okay? Although from a very low level, I must admit, okay? Very low level. For example, in the EAC in 2003-2005, intra-regional flows, FDI flows were practically zero, okay? A few years later, 1.4 billion, okay? And then when you calculate how much, what percentage increase that influence, obviously it will come to a high percentage because we are starting on a very low base. So 14% increase in the space of less than a decade. Okay, and this story occurs across the ranks. COMESA, okay, you see the intra-regional share increasing from 1% to 8%. SADC increasing from 4% to 10%. Okay, when we talk about FDI flows, obviously there is a distinction that needs to be made whether between what is called mergers and acquisition, which is also FDI, and what is called greenfield investment, meaning new investment. Mergers and acquisition means, well, it's already there, the company exists, and it's just being taken over. Okay? Whereas greenfield investment means it's new. It turns out that a lot of the investment, increasingly, an increasing amount of these intra-regional FDI flows, actually are greenfield investments. Greenfield investment has increased from 7% in 2003 to 21%, so a tripling in the space of a decade. That's quite significant, okay? And it's driven by, multinational corporations. And again, you see the role of South Africa there. In the chart we saw earlier, the huge gap that South Africa accounts for, this idea of trade polarization, this has been much discussed in the literature. Okay, South Africa really polarizes trade in the region, and that it doesn't, it's not limited to just trade, it's also in terms of regional investment. South Africa is a dominant player. Another good news is that when you look at FDI flows in the region, it's not extractives. It's not limited to commodities. A lot of the FDI really is about manufacturing and services. Services, obviously, financial services, banking and financial services, but also telecom and retail trade. When it comes to manufacturing, it's not just textiles. You have also agro-processing, which is coming up in a big way. You also have some electronic and electrical equipment. You also have some agro-processing, I mentioned it. Textiles, obviously, is there. So all this, it's a more diversified picture that's emerging. Well, so So I was saying that regional integration has not really advanced as much as we would have wished. Okay? And there are a number of reasons. And these reasons, these factors have been discussed extensively. I will just take a minute to just mention a few of those. And I want to focus here on what I qualify as a sort of political economic perspective on this issue. But my view is that if you look around, regional integration has been driven mainly by the need for to boost trade, the need for economic development. Yes, that need was also there in Africa. But what appears is that in Africa, it's politics which has really sort of taken over, which has been a dominant force. And let's face it, it all comes from the history of Africa. Okay, at the time of independence, many of the countries in Africa left fragmented, and therefore you have countries with really big countries but small populations, geographically scattered, many of them landlocked, long distances between capitals, poor infrastructure, and obviously poverty as well. So there was this need to band together, and that was driven by this, I would say, political rhetoric for African unity, solidarity, peace and security. Not much was being said about trade. The trade discourse came in later, but even when it came in, it didn't get the kind of momentum that you see in other regional blocs as well. And then the fact that there was always this African solidarity that was like center stage, what happened is that when it comes to implementing trade agreements, some countries obviously were not implementing, and you wouldn't sanction those countries. You know, so this idea of, okay, we are all friends, and why should I punish you for not doing something? I mean, it is precisely because of this non-sanctioning, of non-compliance, that there has been what I call muddling through when it comes to implementing regional trade agreements. Countries haven't taken that seriously. And obviously you have other issues, implementation costs and all, and this, I have quoted it, it comes from the African Development Bank. I was surprised actually to read it coming from the African Development Bank. Treaties and protocols outline what should be done, but not how to do it. I think that's very telling. I feel that there has been a lack of leadership, from RECs, from the African Union. I have my friend Babajide who's listening to me, probably will disagree. But I'm happy if you disagree. I mean, the whole point is to have this debate. Yeah? So this lack of leadership is really something that has, and the idea that you are not able to sanction members for not implementing commitments. We really need to do something about that. And low levels of coordination, you see it across the board. I mean, low levels of coordination between RECs, especially when it comes to dealing with multiple membership, low levels of coordination within RECs and implementing ministries, low levels of coordination within a country across departments, between the private sector and the government, the private sector often left out of the process, not consulted. I mean, a whole range of issues. Okay, very quickly now, I think I have used up my time, so this is really the core of the presentation. So, now, as I said, it's really difficult to be talking about all this given the time I'm allowed. But the point really is we are in a global context, which I would say is still characterized by fragility. We thought, you know, the worst was over. US was coming out of recession, the EU was coming out of recession, but just a couple of weeks earlier I was reading this cover page, Economist article saying that, oh, recession might be back. And now, when you look at what's happening in China, it's scary. Yeah? If China goes down, you know, we are in trouble. You can have a sort of a recession of a global scale. So really difficult context. The Doha round, it's unfinished business. Well, some developments, yes. The LGC services waiver, for example, some of the other Bali sort of issues that will hopefully will be implemented. So yes, some positive development, but not exactly what we had in mind initially. But then, and this is really what I wanted to focus on, a number of external forces which are bearing upon regional integration in Africa. So I have basically sort of divided them into challenges and opportunities, but I can tell you this is really a very fuzzy division for me. It's up to you. If you might think EPAS is not a challenge, it's more of an opportunity. So as I said, let's not worry too much about that. So what I think are the challenges are EPAS, how we deal with the EPAS, and the EPs. The EPs are the emerging partners. We're talking about China, obviously the big player in the region now, India, Brazil, the MRs, the mega regionals. We are talking about TTIP, we are talking about TPP, we are talking about RCEP, and even our own mega regionals now, which are coming up, hopefully. TFTA is there, CFTA. Opportunities, AGOA, is it an opportunity? The TFA, the Trade Facilitation Agreement, in my view it is. You have an agreement out there that can address many of the issues that the continent has been grappling for a long time. Why not take it up? Why not embrace FTA? Why this reluctance to implement the TFA? Regional value chains, we'll have a whole session about. So each of these, there are dedicated sessions on this. Very quickly, how much time do I have? 2 minutes. Okay, I have 2 minutes earlier, so they have use of my time. Very quickly, the EPAS. The EPAS, at least when it started out, the idea was that the EPAS would help consolidate regional integration in Africa. But it did the exact opposite. At the very outset, okay, you had countries like Mauritius and some other countries which decided to pull out of the SADC and pull out of COMESA and negotiate separately. So this sort of fragmentation. So really, if you look at it, the EPAS have not started on the right foot. But right now we are in a situation where the EPAS, in a way, are propelling regional integration. Why? Because I think if African countries, RECs, are now sort of conscious of the fact that if they don't do anything to really to deepen regional integration, at the end of the day, they will end up giving more generous market access to the Europeans than they do to their own member states, to their own neighbors. So I think that thinking is driving regional integration, which is good. The changing destinations of African exports, I think this narrative relates to the what I was going to talk about next, which is if you look at how Africa's trade has been changing over time, okay, you could see the emergence of the BRICS. You can see the emergence of China. China, the BRICS as a whole, in 2000, and I'm talking about a very short period of time here, 10, 12 years, 13 years, yeah. So the BRICS accounted for 8% of Africa's exports in 2000. In 2013, 28%. Okay. Intra-Africa trade also has increased. That's a positive story. But as I was saying, not still, we can do better. So let me skip all this. As I said, I won't really have time, really at the outset itself, no time to discuss all this, but you will have the presentation, you will be able to go over it. Let me just very quickly conclude, if I may have 1 minute. Sure. As I was saying at the beginning, interesting times for African integration, many things happening within the continent, the TFA, the CFTA, which is now being discussed, but also, given the sort of external pressures that are bearing on African integration, those things that I mentioned, the mega regionals, EPAS, AGOA, and all that. Integration efforts have lagged at the REC level, as I showed using some of those numbers. But then there are opportunities to strengthen integration. The opportunities, I think, have always been there, except that they have not been leveraged. And then, as I was saying also, we can look at the challenges as really in the flip side of the challenges as opportunities. But then there are a number of questions that remain unanswered. And I'm hoping that we'll have time to bring these questions up and discuss them. TFTA, what, given that we have not been able to really deepen integration at the level of the regs, is going for a more ambitious regional block, the TFTA, and ultimately the CFTA. Is that a good idea? Are you building, you're trying to build a pyramid, but you look at the foundation of it and it appears it's not very strong. Is it a good idea then to continue to build a pyramid on that sort of fragile foundation? So I'll stop there, Chair. Thank you.
Thank you, Vinay, for a very interesting presentation. Jody, the floor is yours.
Firstly, I'd just like to thank ICTSD for organising this meeting and also for the invitation to join you here today. The presentation that I'm going to make to you is based on kind of a number of work streams in which I've been involved in over the last few years, and it draws on a think piece which was submitted to the ICTSD, which is in a kind of draft format. So at the moment, you know, the think piece is in draft, and the ideas that I'm going to run through in this presentation to you today are also quite broad. But there's just one message that I want to get across to you when thinking about this theme, leveraging regional integration as a tool for sustainable development. If we really want to use regional integration in this way, then we really need to better understand the more micro foundations of participation. I think Vinay just kind of touched on the issue when he mentioned about building a pyramid on not very solid foundations. You know, it's really, really important to understand these more micro foundations of participation in trade, and then participation in different types of trade, because intra-regional trade does have a kind of special role, if you like, in terms of helping to promote development objectives. So I'll just kind of run through, a bit of the theory and practice of regional integration, just a bit of a kind of refresh our minds as to what we're talking about exactly. And then I'm going to talk a little bit about kind of stimulating different types of intra-regional trade and intra-regional value chains. Then I'm going to talk a little bit about some of the findings that have been gathered so far from combining different research methods. And then I'm going to talk about the gaps, because there are important information gaps. And if policymakers don't have the right information, you know, they can't make the right decisions. And I think that, you know, this isn't just a challenge for African regional integration, it's also a challenge for European regional integration. So just in terms of the theory, you know, we have the kind of workhorse model of regional integration, and this model showed to us how, you know, you could create trade. There could be a trade creation effect, but there can also be a trade diversion effect. And it's this kind of trade diversion effect which may occur, you know, when you create a customs union, you liberalise tariffs amongst parties that are members, but the tariff barrier remains against external parties. That can have a competitiveness effect, so it can help shift demand towards, you know, producers that are engaged in the regional integration. So this trade diversion effect, it can help address competitiveness challenges. And I think Vinay also touched on this point earlier when he mentioned that efforts to deepen regional integration on the continent are kind of motivated by this recognition that if you don't do that, you know, the benefits, you know, the EU and other large players may get into your intra-regional markets. So it is recognised in theory that regional integration has an important role to play in terms of its developmental effects. Okay. But there are tensions because all parties, you know, they have to balance the fact that there are invariably winners and losers from any trade policy change. And, you know, there can be winners and losers within country, within sector, but there can also be winners and losers at the regional level as well. And so Venables developed his model, he added to the Viner model. And the model developed by Venables was based on the kind of observation as to why did the East African Customs Union break down in the past. Okay, so we have a customs union now, but we also had one in the past and it didn't work. And so Venables kind of explored how and why that was the case, and he drew attention to these forces of kind of trade divergence, and that means economic divergence between members of the regional economic community over time. So there are, you know, these effects are real, they are recognised, and they do require policymakers to act. And in order to act, you need to have the right information. You know, in order to leverage regional integration for development objectives, these can be sustainable development objectives. You know, you really need to understand, you know, there will be winners and losers. And you might need to develop mechanisms to help adjust. So within Africa, you know, the continent has moved and it's begun to underpin its regional integration efforts are underpinned by this development objective, and large actors such as the European Commission are often supportive of this objective. As Vinny mentioned, kind of on paper, in practice, you know, we know that there are kind of tensions there. But nevertheless, the EU has put a lot of money into supporting regional economic corridors, kind of infrastructure projects, and so on. But there's kind of rather less attention has been paid to ensuring that these interventions are underpinned by an appropriate monitoring and evaluation framework. And generally, you know, within the world of aid for trade, we know that generally these monitoring and evaluation frameworks tend to be quite weak, and in some cases they're just absent. But I would argue there's a bigger problem, and that relates to a kind of lack of monitoring and evaluation frameworks more linked to trade policy adjustment more broadly. I mean, we tend to rely on very macro models, which often don't even include, you know, country-specific data. You know, they're often based on proxies, and this is a really, really important gap. And so, it's part of this kind of information deficit, if you like. And I really feel that you know, if we're talking about leveraging regional integration for sustainable development objectives, then we really need to better understand, you know, the more micro foundations of participation. We really need to get this information right. So in terms of African regional integration, as Vinay mentioned, you know, there have been quite some interesting developments. It's not clear to me in terms of how, so you've got regional integration, but you've also got this ascendancy of global value chains. And there's a lot of interest in terms of thinking about regional integration to access global value chains in order to stimulate, you know, more modern sector exports and so on. We have examples from other regions like the EU, Asia, and in Latin America. But from my understanding, I think that there's a combination of approaches within the continent, and you know, the available evidence does suggest that not only is South Africa a kind of key driver of global value chain integration, its process is also helping to kind of leverage in some of the smaller member states. And you know, this regional global value chain interface, the data suggests that it is quite important, because other regions that have, you know, that have done quite well, such as Asia, you know, they tend to have very high shares of intra-regional exports as well. But SADC, you know, is compared to other regions within the continent, it is doing quite well. So we just kind of try to explore a little bit as to, well, what's happening exactly. You know, we've got these new findings from input-output tables looking at global value chains. They suggest that South Africa is kind of driving value chain, global value chain integration within Southern Africa, is helping to bring on board some of the smaller parties. But that's what the kind of more aggregate data suggests. So we just tried to look a little bit deeper, you know, what are the sectors, what are the products, who are the firms, what are the types of firms that are driving these trends. So as I mentioned earlier, trying to get more down to the more better understanding, the more micro foundations of participation. So we, in order to do this, we kind of match trade data with firm level data, and that's not easy. And when you look at kind of publicly available firm level data sources, you know, it can be quite challenging. You have a lot of issues around missing data. But nevertheless, you know, with the World Bank Enterprise Surveys, that's the kind of best information that we have that's publicly available. So we tried to kind of match up trade data to firm level data and just see, you know, can we, if we look at intra-regional trade and the firms linked to those products that tend to be traded more on an intra-regional basis, can we see any difference there in the firm level characteristics? And I have to say that this is still work in progress, but we've identified kind of more conventional value chains where producers and consumers are based within the same region. We've identified what seems to be kind of emerging production networks linked to the automotive industry and the more kind of conventional textiles and apparel and value chain, which Vinay mentioned. And then we tried to explore kind of the firm level characteristics. And we got some interesting results. So foreign owned firms tend to export more to external markets compared to internal markets. Firms with more experienced managers tend to export more to external markets than internal markets. But firm age, and this is often used as a kind of indicator as to the extent to which firms have developed their own kind of domestic capabilities, kind of older firms tend to export more on an intra-regional basis. Okay, and there's a lot of interest in, just to kind of summarize, there's a lot of interest in intra-regional value chains, precisely because of this ability to accumulate more knowledge and skills. So it may be possible to you know, supply branded chocolate in a regional market, whereas you'd have no chance really in the global market. So that's why there's a lot of interest in intra-regional value chains, and you know, the potential for regional integration, because of its it can affect competitiveness, it can also help to stimulate these sorts of value chains, and they might have other kind of benefits, you know, workers thinking about firm ownership structures and so on. You know, these might have, firms might just have different kind of corporate strategies and a level of social embeddedness which is higher, you know, compared to other types of firms which are just using countries as a platform for low-cost labour to export to external markets and so on. So that's where we are so far. And obviously the enterprise surveys, they only include information on the manufacturing sector. And there's, we have agro-processing, we have commodities, we have these other range of sectors as well. And so we kind of looked at, what's going on in these sectors in Southern Africa. We haven't made any direct link, I must say, to trade policy, but I'm just going to run through some graphs with you now, and it's also so you have some charts and figures, so I haven't just presented lots of text, lots of slides with text on you. But if you can see on these graphs, they just show a kind of the productivity, relative productivity level across different sectors in South Africa. And then we've looked at the kind of change in employment share. So if, in an ideal world, we would expect productivity to increase and the share of employment to also increase as we're moving into more value-added activities. In practice, it's really tricky to observe that trend. As firms become more productive, they might actually shed labour, because they might have made an investment in technology. So all of these tensions that policymakers really need to be alive to, and especially if you're kind of trying to use regional integration as a tool to stimulate structural economic transformation. We also looked at Botswana, again trying to look at what's going on across different sectors, what's going on in terms of employment and relative productivity levels. And we've also looked at Namibia and Lesotho and Swaziland. And I'm skipping through the slides quite quickly because this is kind of work in progress. And I've borrowed this data from colleagues at ODI who are undertaking work on structural economic transformation more broadly. Okay, but the main point that I want to get across to you today is that we really need to better understand the more micro foundations of trade, and then the more micro foundations of participation in intra-regional trade compared to with external markets. And that's because of this special role that intra-regional trade can play in terms of developmental events. And without, without that information, policymakers, you can't make the right decisions. And tensions, there are tensions, social and economic, and they can be exacerbated. And within the European Union, you're all aware of the kind of recent Greek crisis. The chief economist is interested in trade policy issues, and even he has noted the fact that even within the European Union we have an absence of really robust detailed firm level information, and he's noted that as a really important gap, and it's now a priority, and that's coming from the chief economist of the European Union. So often, we have a lot of models, we talk at a very high macro level, but when you look deeper into the data that is underpinning those decisions, it's often extremely weak, and it should be of concern when thinking about how to use regional integration as a tool to promote sustainable development. And so I think I'll leave it there. Thank you.
Thank you, Judy, for a very fascinating presentation, focusing our attention on the macro level aspects of participation in regional integration, and also the importance of those aspects for policymakers. I would like to call on Alexa Moitse to make a few remarks with regard to this presentation. So 6 minutes will be fine, I hope. And also, will be followed by Marta, who make a remarks on the presentation for about 6 minutes. And then we'll open the floor for a broader Q&A.
Thank you very much. Can I call you Alfredo? Because I'm not sure how to pronounce the other one. Tijurimo. Did you remember? Chibimo. All right. Thanks. I just have to apologize because I was a bit late, so I missed a bit of what Vinay's presentation, like the intro. But I think that I will just jump into probably our foundational timeframes around the Abuja Treaty and, you know, the timelines that underpin a lot of the, you know, the FTAs and so forth. And I'll say that, you know, maybe I'm going to combine my comments between the two because I think there was a there's an underlying thing that I that resonates with me. Oh, and before I go on, I have to explain that my comments are not Star's comments, they are my comments. And so, you know, if I get carried away, then...
Please do.
Yeah. In terms of those timelines, I think one of the things that we have to be careful of as well is that we're not just ticking boxes that, oh, it's 2015, so now we have a, you know, a TA. And I think that there's a bit of that that goes on. And so it goes on to the detriment of the fundamentals being in place. For example, in your presentation, you're like, oh yeah, in 2008, SAIIA had an FTA. Did SAIIA have an FTA in 2008? We launched an FTA, but I think there were a couple of countries that were not ready to implement. And some of the countries that were not ready to implement in 2008 have, oddly enough, still not implemented in 2015. So maybe we don't have an FTA that we launched. So I think what's happening within SAIIA now is the emphasis on industrial plans and, you know, talking about what your plans are and trying to synthesize that, which is an important leg of the tripartite negotiations as well, which may be the tripartite negotiations kind of saving grace because it's been robust from the beginning. And I'm not saying it's a saving grace because there was something wrong with it in the first place. I think also something Vinay pointed out was the, you know, the non-sanctioning. The non-sanctioning is actually a big problem. We don't have a dispute settlement mechanism. We can't really handle disputes, so we look to the WTO. That's already growing, really. So, I mean, some of these things we have to fix them as we increase as we grow the pyramid. I have a different view about the tripartite FTA now because it is based on the acquis, so it doesn't take the focus away from the the rigor in the reg. So it depends on there being rigor in the reg. So you can't just say, oh no, we moved from there and now we're here. No, you're still here. So there's something about that that's actually useful. I also think that, you know, I'm not an economist, I'm a trade lawyer, but we've done a lot of meetings in Nairobi and we've done meetings in, the last meeting we did was in Tanzania. I cannot believe I forgot the name of the city.
Dar es
Salaam. Right. Now, when you walk around Dar es Salaam, you are conscious of, okay, maybe I'm South African, so I'm not offended by South African investment, but the South African investment, it's robust, there's money pouring in, and it's at the risk of South African. I know, it's like, oh, South Africa's so dominant, but it's, you take a risk when you invest. So, you know, it's really exciting. It just feels to me like it's I want to say it and be politically correct and not say I'm trying to push South Africa, but it's really exciting when South Africa is excited about the continent, you know? And the difference in Nairobi is what you hope to get out of the tripartite, you know, the EAC, because we didn't have any preferential arrangement with Kenya before. So that's all resting on these negotiations. So I don't know. I think it's good to be, you know, and also, you know, I think South African firms are investing more in the continent than in South Africa. So there's that problem that they're not investing here, but, you know, and I think that's a good development, you know, because it is our part of the world, you know. So, you know, when your money follows that decision, it kind of, I don't know, I just think it's really good. So the continental FTA, in my view, will depend on its architecture, and if it's constructed in the same sort of careful way that I think the tripartite is, then it could work. I think what's also interesting about the tripartite is maybe with Egypt, South Africa will stop being a big cat in the house, and somebody else will say, "Oh, the Egyptians are, you know, dominating trade." You know, I think there was just because I'm from customs, I went to pick up on a flyby comment. He actually didn't really, but it was on your side. You saw it on rules of origin. You know, are rules of origin going to be restrictive? Rules of origin, kind of, it's become one of those. I've heard the criticism that static doesn't work because the rules of origin is so complex and so very complex. And in the tripartite negotiations on the rules, it's amazing how similar Commerce's rules and SAIIA rules are. They are like really similar. And the 30% rule, 35% rule doesn't exist. It doesn't, it actually is an alternative that is that never works. I think it works in very few instances. But the reason we managed to conclude the area that we have is EAC, SADC, and the similar rules were huge. It was a huge amount. So it's not a huge amount of work that's left. It's an interesting comment that, oh my goodness, it's on my phone.
You want
that? No, if my phone looks like that, it just would have been really weird. But I'm just saying that if, and also one of the issues that came up with the negotiations, that you have some countries in the north, like Egypt, that want restrictive rules because they want to guard investment in the region. And so you have different schools of thought coming, you know, on board around rules of origin. And I really think that maybe that's an area that deserves to really be tested and looked at, and not just, you know, the same comment flung at it that's been flung at it for the last 15 years, you know? It's like, come on, is this really the case? In terms of Jody's presentation, the only criticism is, I think that the cure to rigor cannot be the EU having a monitoring mechanism. I think it has to be us, you know, member states. It has to be member state driven. The member states have to look at the gaps and take them seriously, you know, particularly the non-sanctioning, and also, you know, to look at the real reasons why we're not progressing, you know. So, you know, why are we not moving to a customs union? Is it because people depend on tariffs? And if economies depend on tariffs, then you're never going to move to a customs union. So it's pie in the sky. So maybe it's time to, you know, assess what we really think. And,
yeah. presentation is very good and very motivating. But unfortunately, it makes my heart sore because all what you have said is affecting the women across the SAIIA region. I want to start with the border. In the borders, there's a problem, very problem, because our women in SAIIA region, they have a lack of information on the existing legal custom and regulation. They don't know how to do and how to behave to move to across the border. And also, there's a problem in the borders because there's a low security level at border post where women are harassed during transit. And high level of corruption by officials at border post, they take chances. We found that the women there, they have to pay a lot of. We found out that the women there in the borders, they have to pay a lot of money to cross the border. Sometimes they have given to places with the officials or with the police because they don't know how to do. They say it's a crisis in the borders. The women are harassed. And then when Judy said you will talk about other things, and aqua is very important and is very good and I like it. But one day I imagine if when I woke up and I found that aqua is finished, what can the women do, especially in Lesotho? Because Lesotho aqua gives the women the jobs between 40,000 and 50,000 jobs. But if the aqua is closed, Lesotho, I think all the people will eat all the people because it will be no work for the women and it will be a disaster. That's why I think, and you just talk again about the value chain. I think we have to move to another value chain, not only in the manufacturing, the dress and so on. We have to make it for agro business so that we have to work. We have to work to create more jobs. And that's why the Federation of Lesotho Objectives, and then we stand up as a federation, and then we want to start to create more jobs, not only Lesotho, but only for southern countries. Then the objective of the federation is to promote economy, empowerment of women in Lesotho. We want to represent their concern, ideas and challenge regarding the obstruction they meet in their attempts to start their own business. We therefore seek to engage activity with the government to address these challenges through review and challenge in the law and legislation and regulations which make it difficult for us to start businesses. We need to work with banks and influence them to relax their loan requirement towards women and enable women to have equal access to loan without the permission of their husband. Here again is the problem. We found that each and everything, as a woman, we don't have the issues to get without your husband. Even if the husband stay here in Georgetown and play here, and having a girlfriend here, and if you are at home with your children, we will find that you will take the care of the family, cows, and everything. If your child is sick, you are not allowed to sell that child, that cow, because it has been snow day. You have to ask the permission, and if you should go to the chief, hey chief, my chief, you see my child is sick. They say, no. Your husband is not there. But he's still eating the chips on the street of Westland. So the women are so frustrated in this Sadakaris. I'm sorry to say that because I know that the men here, they will kill me. I'm so sorry. We also want to be able to access to loans. We also want able to own land and property in our own right so that we can start our own businesses. at a preferred location of your choice. The Lesotho law does not recognize women's rights in inheritance to property of their parents. As a result, young women are born already disfranchised, and this empowerment is empowered because the parents' property can only be given to the boys. It's true here in African people, they take boys are only the good people, only the respected people, only people is the God. Boys always are God. But the girls always, they are not taking them seriously. The law needs to change so that the young women can share if in the inheritance and he gives capacity to grow the social economy. We need to network with women across the world to share experiences, ideas, and trade with one another. For this to happen, we need agent training and technical assistance so that our products can gain access to international markets. Donor support by way of finances and other forms of assistance is most welcome. Women cannot achieve all these things alone. We need to support and champions from our husbands, brothers, sons, and chiefs, because our economic achievements are not only for us as women, but for all families and the nation as a whole. Women have a crucial role to fight poverty, but if we are not given the tools and we are gradually being excluded by laws and regulation from participating in the growth of our countries, this poverty cycle cannot be broken. Women are 51% of our nations, and if this number is economically inactive or operates on the margin instead of mainstream economy, poverty shall never be stopped.
Thank you very much for introducing your specific gender perspective. I think we'll open the floor for questions and comments, and then we'll allow our two presenters to respond to those, including the points made by the two discussants.
This is a suggestion from my side with regards to gender equality. I believe that with myself working on the ground as a female entrepreneur, any business, access to markets and understanding the trades becomes very complex. So my suggestion would be what we are doing at the moment with Commonwealth Business Women is doing trade missions and having access to markets, but it's still quite complex. So for me, it would be for us to have more workshops, giving more empowerment in workshops from levels like the ICTSD, the Commonwealth Business Women, to understand what are the different challenges and how to access international and regional markets as well. So just my suggestion on it. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I'd just like to make a very brief comment, touching on both presentations as to the imperative of integration. Why is it so important beyond it being a political exercise and our heads of state like to come together to announce very ambitious targets, shake hands, take pictures, and so on and so forth. But then the fact is that beyond the political exercise, economic integration is essential for Africa's development. And you know, I'm not going to go into the depth of the literature that has been written on it, but from a market perspective, the average African country, the markets are simply too small for them to be able to sustain their development and growth prospects. And as such, because the markets are too small, the market is too small to even generate the right kinds of investments, right? As in, how often would you find, maybe for example, a 500 million tech investment in a country that has 2 million people, for example? What kind of economic sense would it make? So because the sizes of the market are too small, there is that imperative for them to expand their market sizes through economic integration. And that is the economic rationale why it is, why we are pushing it. Then the second thing is about the urgency of the matter. It's very interesting, you know, just looking at it now, that the Abuja Treaty, right, was even was signed, agreed, and ratified even before the WTO came into existence. And the fact is that the global environment has changed significantly, and it hasn't necessarily changed for the better, in the sense that the window of opportunity that Africa has to make integration work for it has, you know, is shrinking, and you know, continues to shrink. So, for example, if we look at when the Abuja Treaty was being agreed, we did not have the economic partnership agreements, for example. So it means that even though we have not resolved our own economic integration agenda, it means that, for example, the EU has better market access to ECOWAS than South Africa does. And if we understand the things about, you know, first mover advantage and so on and so forth, we discover that these opportunities are shrinking. So it's not only important, it is also imperative. And as such, we may not have so much time as we think to fine-tune and complete our integration agenda, as we'll have said. And if the commenter, if the presenters can just reflect on that, it will also be quite useful.
Apologize for standing up. I just have a few points. First of all, I thought both presentations were quite remarkable just in terms of the data and unpacking the questions. So thank you for that, and thank you to the discussants as well. You know, I come from the private sector. I'm serving as head of strategy for Barclays Africa for our 12 countries outside South Africa. But today I want to take off my private sector hat, just speak in my personal capacity, and share some views from a different seat, which is the World Economic Forum Global Agenda Councils. And I serve on the United States Global Agenda Council as one of the African delegates. And this issue of trade is fundamental to what we look at as well. And we work quite closely with the Africa Global Agenda Council. And a couple of themes that emerge from these different workshops, which were echoed here. I think the first is that the intra-Africa trade issue is fundamental, much to the eloquent points made here, because some markets are too small. But within that, you know, what I think would be exciting is this concept of value chains, that the rules of the game on the trade agreements are absolutely fundamental, but as practitioners on the ground, it is the value chain of supporting entrepreneurs, the manufacturing sector, and ultimately access to markets that drive things, access to finance, the mentorship. And so, you know, the question I would have for the esteemed colleagues, I'm by no means a trade expert, you know, a practitioner, is we understand what's needed as Africa Inc., be it East Africa, SADC, our North African partners, West Africa partners, but Africa as a whole is, you know, is it simply an issue of political will to really tackle some of these issues, which was raised? I like the point Jody made on you know, this tension between losing control within your country versus the so-called greater good. And one of the things that came up at the WEF repeatedly was projects like Grand Inga, big infrastructure projects that need regional partners to come together to unlock value. And it'll be very interesting, just, you know, while, you know, the esteemed colleagues here come from it, from policy and economics and the, you know, the trade agreements, to really zone in on particular change the game projects across the value chain. So, you know,
without speaking on behalf of my colleagues from the Africa Global Agenda Council, one of the projects they embarked upon was simply the movement of people across borders. Why is it so difficult for our brothers and sisters from Togo or Mali to move to a neighboring country? You know, it's easier for for folks from other countries to move into Africa. So tangible projects of movements of people is playing a role simply in unlocking labor markets. So it would be great just as a practitioner to say, what are some of these building blocks? And I apologize, I'm not preaching, I'm talking to the converted. These issues of labor, these issues of entrepreneurship, like the women's rights, and how do these practical aspects come in? And very much this issue of infrastructure. My last point is, again, I didn't see China come up very, very much, but again, it was another point that was quite important at this last World Economic Forum, and certainly the meetings that I sat in, is that it is not good or bad. As an African, I'm really grateful for people that want to trade with the continent. But again, how do these trade agreements, particularly with these big building blocks that we mentioned AGOA, I would be very curious as how Africa Inc. Is thinking through the positive aspects, particularly around beneficiation and moving up those value chains. So just a series of thoughts, very excited to be here to share this morning. And thank you again for the data and statistics. Final point, I really like the graph on how the different trade regions with the intensity on the trade factor. It'd be interesting to see the calculation and the footnote. But I think that's a very important message, particularly for the different regions. Coming from a practitioner's perspective, it would be very interesting to have a basic toolkit on what can be done and the levers that will increase that kind of activity between the different areas. Very practical, very tangible. And then from the business side, what can business do? And I know it's increased lending and increased risk appetite and the usual things, but from a practical perspective, what are some of those partnerships in which risk sharing can take place that can be discussed? Thank you.
Paul, please keep your comments brief.
Thank you, Afonso, and I will definitely be brief because the gentleman on my side have definitely taken all of my points. But I think one of the issues that they raised drives intra-African integration. And lately we have seen the emergence of the regional value chains. But I think one important issue will be the development of the local value chains, because looking at the countries like Lesotho, which is totally surrounded by South Africa, I think the important factor will be building within before even thinking about going into the regional value chains. I think my colleague from the Women Federation has an important issue about the committees that they have in their federation about building locally before even thinking about going regionally. But I think the importance of going regionally is the issue that Vinay raised about the textiles, looking at the automotives. I think that's another element that we've seen really making progress in, mostly in Lesotho recently. Looking at the issue of politics versus the economics of regional integration, I think that's also an important element, because we have seen the emergence of SADC, which Palesa said it very well. Is SADC a free trade area? We're still wondering that also, even though we're in the SADC region. Because I think the fundamentals of the need to sanction members, if we have that in place but it's not well functioning, what are we doing? And also moving from SADC to the TFTA, yet we don't have the perfect basis for that. I think that also has to be reviewed, because when you have issues like the sanctioning, it will also put more emphasis on the need for implementation, which I think could be an important base from the SADC to the TFTA and most importantly to the CFTA. I think another element, the last one, was the issue of AGOA, opportunities versus challenges. I think we have seen over the years, my country for example, AGOA has been a perfect opportunity, but are we taking advantage of AGOA fully? I think that's another element that we as the sub-Saharan African countries that are benefiting should look into. And I've seen lately the emergence of the development of the AGOA response strategies, which I think if they are well developed and fully implemented, they could bear very good results. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. I just wanted to make comments on the presentation that you made. I saw that the figures on agriculture were a bit low. I believe those figures were from South Africa. Countries like Malawi, we are agro-based country, but the challenge that we have is that we have problems in the value addition, and the reason might be because our financing, the financing aspect is on the higher side, especially on the interest rates. South Africa has an advantage because there are simple banks and their interest rates are low. However, within SAIIA, we have an advantage because Africa is a global-based economy. The countries in Africa, they grow. If we go into value addition, we could be competitive, and we could increase trade amongst ourselves. So I've seen the bankers are here. We're going to discuss on how they can help on the investments in agriculture and the Malawi in particular. And at the same time, as it was discussed on the AGOA, Malawi hasn't benefited much on the AGOA, but I know there is a political will now. They want to increase on the AGOA because we've increased our hectareage on cotton, which will increase on the AGOA exports. Thank you.
Judy, you might want to start, and then we will pick up from where you did. Let's keep the responses short because we are running out of time. We have to finish this session latest at 11:05, and that would mean we might have to steal a few minutes from your lunch because the second session will also have to take place.
Thank you. They're really excellent questions. I'll try and address all of them. My head also started to spin when I was also thinking about just how weak our tools are for assessing the impact assessment of trade, and then thinking about how these effects then filter through the economy and affect different groups. And within the Secretariat, I have some colleagues who have devoted a lot of time actually into looking at who's involved in the actual trade policy negotiations themselves and what's the kind of gender and balance and composition there. I think once you start thinking of looking at things through the gender lens, I mean it really does I've really learnt a lot. I just haven't really given it too much thought in the past. To be frank, but thankfully, we've got the post 2015 agenda, and the SDGs include a number of kind of gender-related targets in there, and just general advocacy and awareness raising. I think in terms of the specific national legislation, there's not much that international agencies can do about that, apart from advocate and provide resources to help impact assessments to be undertaken in a more thorough, kind of robust way. I mean, that would be helpful, I think. In terms of the, building local, then going regional, and comment and so on, I absolutely, I share that point of view, and that's the whole point I was trying to get across, really, is this special developmental role that regional integration can play in helping to support those processes. And in terms of the urgency, I think Jude mentioned the urgency of addressing these information gaps, given that the EU has better market access in ECOWAS than South Africa. it is really, really urgent. And you know, things are unlikely to bite soon. Obviously, it depends on if the EPAs are even implemented. I mean, I know in the Caribbean, there's been such challenges in terms of, you know, tariff revenue. If you liberalize, you're going to lose tariff revenue. And the state just simply can't afford to do it. And so it hasn't. There's been very limited progress there in terms of implementation. You know, impact assessments, they should have picked up on these issues. But when you look through, as I mentioned earlier, the kind of analytical base, it's so weak. And that has kind of helped to underpin aid for trade resources. So I'm not surprised, you know, that there's been limited implementation. But it might bite. And, you know, I think there is, you know, there is a need to urgently look into this and just better understand how existing value chains might be affected. And that does mean that you need to look at trade in a kind of different way, and you need to move away from just looking at trade in final goods, but adopt more of a kind of whole of supply chain approach. And I think that was touched upon by the intervention by the guy from Ivan from Barclays. So adopting this more whole of supply chain approach, thinking about the final product, the branding, the marketing, the services that have gone into that, or if you're exporting a final product, what are the, where are the intermediate inputs, where are they coming from? It is a different approach, it requires a different mindset, and I think you know, we're just moving into this kind of new approach now. And I think I'll leave it there.
Thank you. I'll try to pick up some comments. I think very interesting comments, Alisa. Thank you for your very upbeat tone, I would say, also. The question of rules of origin, complex rules of origin, and all that, that's well taken. So there will be further discussion on this in the dialogue. I didn't want to really focus on that. I was surprised, though, that when you mentioned that Egypt wants restrictive rules of origin, I thought it was South Africa. So, again, we can discuss this later. And then why aren't we moving to customs union? Whether it's a question of dependence on China? I would say yes. Unfortunately, that's what appears to be the case. Many countries are still very, especially when it comes to the LDCs in the region, highly dependent on tariff revenue as a source of government revenue. Many products considered sensitive from a revenue point of view, not because, you know, you liberalize and then you will, that will cause injury to your local industry, because there is very little industry as such. So when it comes to sensitive products, really these are revenue sensitive products. But things are changing, I think. Things are changing because when you look at from a more sort of a global perspective in Africa, you look at, for example, resource mobilization, you will see that the share of domestic resource mobilization, okay, rather than from trade, but more from locals and taxes and all, that's increasing. So my hope is that at some point, countries will be generating enough from these sources so they become less dependent on tariffs, and therefore that will make it easier for them to liberalize and then facilitate the move to customs union. Baba Jide, thank you again for your comment. I think you know, you mentioned this need for urgency and all. You raised a question, I didn't quite pick it up, but you can again discuss it later. The question of, is it really a lack of political will to tackle the issues that you mentioned? Why not unlock value? How can we unlock value? I think beyond political will, the problem is that when you look at Africa, African production and trade still is highly dominated by commodities. Okay? And those commodities obviously create very little room for value addition, but also very little room for trade. When you look at, and this is a point that I didn't mention, but when you look at Africa's trade in Africa, within Africa, as opposed to Africa's trade with the rest of the world, it's a very interesting picture that emerges. Africa's trade with the rest of the world is very much concentrated in commodities, oil, you know, hard and soft commodities. But when you look at Africa's trade in the region, intra-regional trade, you see a higher share of manufacturers. And I think the story that's coming out is that you have more possibility to trade when you're producing higher value added processed products manufactured. So I think it's a very telling point, because what it says is, one reason why we have this lack of integration and low levels of intra-regional trade is precisely because Africa still is a much bigger producer of commodities than it is of manufacturers. Okay, and that goes to basically emphasizing the need for structural transformation in Africa. We have been talking about this all the time, yes? But unfortunately, if you look at the situation that we have now compared to maybe 10, 15 years back, I don't think things have improved. If anything, things have gotten worse. Okay, you have China, you raise also the question of China. China has come along, some other emerging partners are coming along, and the usual discourse is that these countries are here in Africa for Africa's natural resources. And what is happening is that they have the effect of perpetuating this sort of dependence on commodities. And in a way, that has made it more difficult for countries to move out of natural resources and go into higher value-added, more processed types of products. But I think the need for structural transformation is urgent now more than ever. As you know, oil prices are practically collapsing now. The commodity boom is over. Okay, at some point, obviously, there was this sort of lot of enthusiasm about it. But we have come full circle. And I think historically, when you look at the evolution of terms of trade, you have this so-called traditional single hypothesis that over a long period of time, terms of trade decline. Yeah, and that was the reason why countries, developing countries, should be moving out of, terms of trade of agricultural products, primary products decline. So that was the reason for these countries to move out of primary production into more manufacturers and services. We are not talking about services. Services are big, and ICTSD, actually, we are doing a lot of work on services, and hopefully we'll have a chance to talk about this in the course of the of this dialogue. Services are very important also, and you have a number of countries that are developing services. I think there was a point about, Paul actually raised this idea about, yes, we're talking about global value chains, we want to talk about regional value chains, what about local value chains? Really, how do you build up from scratch, And there you see the role that services can play. We don't talk about services, okay, because there are few countries actually that really export services as such. Okay? But let us not forget one thing, and this is something that is coming up increasingly from the data that we have today, which is that a lot of value added in goods is actually coming from services. Services value added is embedded in goods. Okay? There have been some estimates about 50%. So that tells you that, and I was reading this very interesting, you might be surprised, this global, Fung Global Institute study of a bakery in Hong Kong. A bakery, so we're talking about a bread, very basic product, okay? And they basically have documented the number of services that go into the production of a loaf of bread. Amazing. You have about 30 different kinds of services that go into the production of a loaf of bread. And those services account for 72% of the value of the bread. So let us not forget services. I think we tend to ignore services because of our focus on physical, tangible goods.
But services are very much embedded in goods. Okay? And if you really want to go out of this, you know, dependence on commodities, move out of this commodity trap, services definitely is one way to go. But it shouldn't be at it shouldn't be at the cost of manufacturing. Value added in manufacturing also is very important. So a number of other issues that I have noted here, again, because we are pressed for time, and we can discuss this with John. I think John had a question on value addition and the financing issue. I think it's a very important issue. As you know, as I mentioned also briefly in my presentation, what we see is this sort of a trend in cross-border financing. Okay, banks are now moving across borders. And the story that comes out with that is that this is good when it comes to value chain financing. Because you have local banks, they have an understanding of the local context, and hopefully that would help in financing value chains. Again, however, that is more theory than practice. You know that, okay? In practice, when it comes to financing, those which are really left out are the SMEs, those who actually need the financing. Okay? Financing goes typically to the biggest firms, okay? Because for them it's easier. They can provide, they have the reputation, they can provide collateral, you know. The problem really is with small and medium enterprises. I remember at some point the African Development Bank was talking about what is called syndication. Syndication meaning that you know different kinds of financiers can band together and finance a project. But usually this idea occurs in the context of large projects where, you know, we are talking about billions of dollars. But I think the idea applies also when it comes to risk mitigation. Because I can't finance your company, for example, because for me it's too risky. Okay, why not share that risk among, you know, a group of financiers? Then this risk spread out. Okay, if ever there is a problem, then I am not hard hit as I would be if I were alone. So these are ideas that we need to explore. But hopefully with this trend in cross-border financing, things might happen. But the national government also has a role to play. Okay. Just 1 second, Chair. From our work, we were doing these field studies in some East African countries, and it appears that even we were talking to the SME Association, okay? And we learned that in one country, I'm not going to mention the country, you probably know, that the government wants to encourage SMEs. Obviously, all governments want to encourage SMEs because SMEs of today are the big firms of tomorrow. Yeah? But in this country, there is no national SME strategy. There is no strategy as such. So when you lack a strategy, how do you really boost SMEs? So I think it comes from the top, really. You need sort of the government to provide sort of guidance. And once you have that sort of strategy and guidance, then things it's easier for things to just fall. Thank you.
Thank you, Bini. I thought you would end on a very optimistic note, but just reminded that there's no national SME story in this country. Please join me in thanking our two presenters, as well as Marga and Palesa, for animating this conversation. We will break for 10 minutes and reconvene at 11:15 for the second session. So I think we should thank our presenters.
We have to do this. But you mentioned the companies in Java changed before it's the first paper.
Yeah. Yeah. planet.
Thank you.
The reason why I was showing three people was because of, she said I want to see the names. Yes. So I was showing the names.
Still showed. Much
showed. Oh, much of the names. Because with the side angle, if I have to show him straight, I have to be in the middle. So that's because look, let me show you. You see with him.
Okay, we can start the discussion and then everybody's going.
I understand. But they in Geneva said they want to see the next. Still keep them.
Because if it was a straight angle,
yeah.
With him, I understand. I could just. Okay, let me put them in. You see.
See when you switch it. I wasn't taking his camera. He got it. So I took his. So don't worry too much. If it's this quad, he should be able to take it. So even down here, he was catching.
Yeah, I can catch this. I can catch it.
But just try not to catch it.
Yeah, okay.
Will you be able to do that?
I
No worries, no
problem.
Vinay, sorry, that's
that's you?
You are now. See, come into it. Camera must take them everywhere. I'm not just a
Welcome to welcome to the second session that looks specifically at SADC, maximizing opportunities for growth through SADC integration. In the first session, there was a slide that specifically referred to SADC as one of the best students, so to speak, when it comes to integration. And I do hope that this conversation will be deepened by our two competent speakers as well as the discussant.
let me invite to the floor Mark Pearson, who will speak on SADC integration, how we get in. And then Rachel will talk on from a commercial perspective, if we are reducing trade costs and what are the benefits from the trade facilitation agreement. I think these are two interesting topics that both speakers will try to unpack for the benefit of the broader conversation. Mark, you have 20 minutes. Rachel, you also have 20 minutes because I'm worried that if we continue at the pace of the previous session, you will not have lunch. So it's up to you. Mark, the floor is yours.
Thank you very much. I'm sorry, I have a bit of a cold, so frog in my throat. Hopefully I can get through in 20 minutes. As the previous speakers have said, there's quite a lot to cover. But quickly straight into it. We did do some background papers for this conference. So this is really just a summary of some of the issues that were raised in the papers that I did present as well. The challenges to deeper integration in SADC. I think first of all, I'd just like to start off, I think, from where people were talking about in the morning. Structural challenges, the structure of SADC as an integration organization. We all know that SADC came out of SADCC, and SADCC was really preoccupied with, it was a movement by the frontline states to try and use regional cooperation to safeguard individual statehood. So I think that is a fundamental issue from the very beginning, in that when countries in Africa became independent, they were not nation states. They had to start to develop and to become nation states. I come from Zambia, and Kenneth Kaunda is often vilified for destroying the economy, whereas actually what he was trying to do was to create a nation state, and I think he probably did that quite well. But the SADC of today is the basis of is still running the same kinds of systems as SADC with two seats. In SADC, as in all regional organizations, as in the African Union, we have a very hierarchical decision-making process, which is based on politics rather than technical aspects. The issues are really, we want to achieve a free trade area by such and such a time. Now, no one has actually said how long will it actually take you to get to a free trade area, because no one's actually said where are you now and what do you need to do to get there and how long is it going to take. It's a free trade area is something we need to achieve, therefore by diktat we're going to do it in 5 years, or we're going to do it in 3 years, or we're going to do it in whatever time it is, without really looking at the technical implications of what that involves and how long that will take. As was said this morning, there are no sanctions for non-compliance. Domestication of regional decisions is optional. You can decide you're going to do it or not. You just have to go to a SADC heads of state and he says, yes, I agree to that, and then you go away and forget about it and no one is going to do anything about it. So you can say that we are not rules-based in that respect. Trade policy challenges. I think as was said this morning, there's very little change in SADC trade volumes before and after the SADC FTA. So you can't say that the SADC FTA has had a major impact on volumes. I would argue that stringent rules of origin and slow progress in completing the tariff phase down didn't help this. Palesa was saying that the rules of origin of SADC and COMESA are pretty much the same. I think the problem is not that they're the same. The problem is what they're based on. The COMESA rules of origin is a general rule which covers everything, and then you can negotiate differences. So the SADC rules of origin, you have to negotiate every rule line by line. So until you finish those negotiations, you don't have any rules of origin. So those are the main differences. It's not the fact that you use a value addition criteria or you use a change of tariff criteria, etc. And the tariff phase down, I think it's clear that some countries haven't completed their tariff phase down even yet, so on the SAIIA FTA. Would the SAIIA FTA stimulate trade? I think there you have to assume that if it's going to stimulate trade, there it would be done through getting investment into productive sectors, and then the productive sectors would take advantage of the environment, the trade environment. Because at the moment, one of the main reasons why there's no trade between SAIIA countries is because SAIIA countries don't produce very much, and they can't produce and they can't trade with that. So, again, take a country like Zambia, main production is copper cathodes. Who are they going to trade copper cathodes with? They're going to trade copper cathodes with China, pretty much, or copper anodes as well. So I think there is an issue in terms of the FTA itself is going to be an enabling environment for investment to take place, for more trade to take place. It's not necessarily the case that day one you get your trade environment, day two you get increases in trade. The benefits of the SAIIA FTA are not clear to some. I mean, it's based on the theory that you will create an enabling environment, just like EPA's, and EPA will create an enabling environment, and therefore you will get investment, which will then lead to increased production and increased value addition in the region and in the countries concerned. But in the meantime, maybe there will be job losses. In the meantime, maybe there will be industrial relocations, and in the meantime, maybe there will be revenue losses as well, in the short term. And the challenge for SADC is, and the challenge for most regional organizations, is that how does a country actually address those issues in the short term? You're a politician, you've been elected for 5 years. In that time, you say, we're going to go to a free trade area. Immediately what happens is there's a readjustment in your country, and some industries say, well, we'd be better off by relocating to another country, or we'd be better off by moving some production. In the long term, that is going to even out, and everyone will benefit, because there'll be more trade and there'll be more industrial production taking place. But in the short term, which is what the politician worries about, it's going to be in his watch, and is he going to be elected again in the short term? That is the issue, and there are no mechanisms in any regional organization that take account of that short-term problem. So it's a very brave person. I'm talking, sitting next to a very brave person. Very brave person that is going to take that decision to liberalize trade in the belief that longer term it is going to benefit the region and is going to benefit the country. And I believe that is what will happen. But the challenge is to overcome that very short term issue. The dominance of South Africa is also a challenge. South Africa has got market access to the rest of Africa, despite the fact it doesn't have preferential access. It's done that despite the fact that there are no trade issues that it's going to benefit from. It's not because of that. It hasn't gone into markets in Kenya or markets into Nigeria, etc., because of any trade arrangements. It's gone in there despite the fact that it hasn't got those trade arrangements. So, given that, what are you going to say to the private sector in South Africa to say, okay, we now want you to open up your markets so that other people can come in and liberalize and take advantage of that? Now, that is something which is difficult to overcome. It's something which the private sector will understand. Why should I open up my markets? Well, I didn't have market access when I first started, so how am I going to get market access? Now, these are issues which I'm not saying I necessarily agree with, but I think those are challenges which need to take into account in any regional integration process that is not being taken account of at the moment. And if we're going to improve regional integration, then I think we need to be or not pessimistic or optimistic, but we need to be realistic about what the challenges are so that we can address the challenges. The tripod FTA, is it going to be the answer to deepen integration? I think it can be. And the tripod FTA is designed so that it will replace the Comesa, SADC and EAC FTAs, and it then addresses the issue of overlapping membership, the issue of differential rules of origin, etc., etc. But it can only do that if it is based on the acquis. And the acquis is that you need to start from where each of the regional organizations have left off, if you like. So you can't go below that, which is also important if you're going to get Article 24 recognition, which is important for the bigger countries in the WTO. And I can explain that more, but I don't want to explain that at the moment. Non-tariff barriers. I think most commentators now would say that the challenges facing regional trade are more to do with non-tariff barriers and trade facilitation than they are to do with tariffs. There are more costs involved in overcoming non-tariff barriers and overcoming the trade facilitation costs or cost of transport and logistics than they are in terms of the tariffs that you have to pay on goods and services. Oh, good, sorry. NTBs, there's quite a good monitoring mechanism that all tripartite countries use. And it's pretty much a name and shame game. They try and just say, okay, these are the NTBs, get rid of it. And it is quite successful in removing NTBs and to do it on a informal basis before it becomes a formal issue. I mean, you can go to the website and see how many NTBs have been removed, which ones are still pending, and which ones are not able to be addressed. Trade facilitation and the cost of transport and logistics are still a major impediment to trade and economic growth. It's still the case that if you move something along a corridor, the costs about $1,800 to land a container in Durban or Dar es Salaam or Maputo or Warbish Bay, any of those places. And that will cost you probably three or four times as much to move that container inland. So because of that, and because of the way that modern or modern manufacturing takes place, where you basically assemble goods from all over the world, no one is going to be locating a processing or a manufacturing industry on the other end of the corridor that's costing $8,000 or $5,000 to move, so that they can then, instead they would put it on the port or something like that, or nearer to the port. So we need to, before there's going to be growth, there needs to be a reduction in the cost of trade and the cost of transport. Customs and border clearance, a lot has been done to improve customs and customs procedures and clearance procedures in the SADC region and pretty much all over Africa, which is a lot to do with the World Customs Organization and the various programs that they are running. Usually now delays at borders are more to do with other things than customs, unless it's done deliberately, because there's money in chaos. If you have a chaotic situation, then someone working at the border can get money from you to ease the chaos, if you like. There's money in queue management in borders. There's money in delaying clearances, etc. But the systems are in place, and I think that it's clear that those systems are working. Fees, permit charges, taxes along the corridor nullify revenue effects. If you have to pay taxes on transport, so for example, in South Africa, transport taxes produce about 176 million rand to the treasury in terms of the taxes that they have. Now, the problem with that is the people who are paying those taxes either get their money back in terms of their income tax returns, or they pass it on to the country where that's going. So by taxing a transport going through South Africa, you are then increasing the cost of that import in Zambia, in Zimbabwe, in DR Congo, etc. It also skews the revenues in the SADC region and skews competitiveness. If you take, for example, the cost of a carrier's license, in SADC, in all regional organizations, you have to have a carrier's license if you pick up a backload, meaning that you can transport to one country and you need to be registered as a carrier in that country to get back so that you can pick up a backload. In Zambia, the cost of a SADC permit, carrier's license, is $40 for all SADC countries. It covers all SADC countries. In South Africa, it's $700 for each country. So obviously, you're not going to be wanting, if you're doing a lot of transporting around the region, you're not going to be wanting to be registered in Zambia, which is why most transporters have offices in the SADC region as well, because they can reduce costs, and they can also use left-hand drive vehicles. We need to introduce or fully implement a coordinated integrated border management system, which basically means that you don't have 16 or 17 agencies all working differently to each other. And there is a lot of work that's been done on that. In South Africa, there's a Border Management Act, which introduces this kind of coordination or integration, and a lot of other countries are doing the same thing. And finally, implement the WTO Trade Facilitation Agreement. I personally think that is something which is going to seriously improve trade facilitation, reduce the cost of trade facilitation in the SADC region. I know it only deals with Article 5, 8, and 10 of GATT, but it's not the issue of what it deals with, it's the issue of how it's being designed, where you basically do a needs assessment, you then prepare a program to address those issues, and then you get money to implement it. Free movement of labor. There is no free movement of labor in SADC, pretty much. and it's not because we're all xenophobic and we hate each other, but there is a reason, and I don't know what the reason is. In EAC and in EAC and in ECOWAS, they've made much more progress. So why is it that SADC, we're not able to make progress? Rule of law and human rights, there is, according to the Mo Ibrahim Foundation, has this Ibrahim Index of African Governance. Just to quickly skip over that, to say that SADC is integrating in these areas. Integration through infrastructure. SADC is, compared to the rest of Africa, is really, really well serviced by infrastructure and by interlinkages in infrastructure. Theoretically, you can have a train, you can take a train from Lobito in Angola and go to Durban. Or you can take a train from Dar es Salaam and go to Walvis Bay. There are tracks, and they're all the same gauge to do that. So the interlinks are there. The SADC Regional Trunk Road Network pretty much doesn't have very many gaps in it, and it is in relatively good condition. We have some of the largest and most efficient ports in Africa, in the SADC region. And air transport is pretty good as well, in that there are city pairings in at least on a weekly basis, if not on a daily basis. Energy, we have the Southern African Power Pool, which is probably the most efficient power pool that there is in Africa. I'm looking across and I'm seeing Mauritians, so I've got to leave you out of these things, sorry. And also Seychelles as well. In ICT, we have quite large undersea cables and quite good linkages to those undersea cables on the backhauls. So, lessons learned. First lesson is it's not easy. And here I just want to do a comparison of the European situation with the African situation. In European, I chose the European one because we always seem to be using that as the model. First of all, you've got to have a catastrophic war. You've got to really hammer each other. Next thing you do is you design a plan to make sure that war is not merely unthinkable, but materially impossible. That's what Schuman said in the Schuman Declaration, that we are going to create that with that situation. Next thing you do, we're already industrialized. We're not using integration to industrialize. We're industrialized. So now we're going to make sure that in coal and steel, France and Germany can't operate without each other. So we're going to make it impossible for them to not be together, to have regional integration. Then what you do is you do an assessment of each member state's regulatory and institutional environment. You plan how they will move from where they are to a single market and make money available and provide assistance from a regional level. You look at the white paper, the Dlores white paper, 1985, and you will see exactly that. They go into each country and they say, what institutions do you have in place now? What is it that you need to do to get from where you are to where you need to be in 1992? And then, how are you going to move that? And what technical inputs you need to do? And then you provide the money. Now compare that to Africa, where we have the nearest thing is the BIAT, the Building Inter-Africa Trade, where basically it is, this is what you need to do, get on and do it. The same kind of issue. And by the way, find the money as well, worry about it. Then you have to apply a legally enforceable sanctions if a member state does not comply with a decision taken at a regional level, and you need to make sure that you do impose those that rule of law. Then you create a supranational authority which national governments have to cede responsibility to in certain areas, and they have certain and they have a legislative powers. So you have integration by law in effect. In Africa, first of all, we get colonized, and then we get independent, and then we keep the borders the colonial powers drew for us. So basically, if you look at the 1900, that's the on the left-hand side, that is the borders that were drawn up by the Berlin Conference in 1884-85, pretty much. Just keep your eye on Leopold's Congo, because that doesn't change in all the time. Then 1926 to 1940, basically that's interwar period. Thank you. Interwar period, nothing much has changed really. Then 1951 to 1960, which was pre-independence for countries in southern Africa, you have the borders which are pretty much the same as they are today. So in all that time, from pre-independent, from pre-colonial to colonial to independence, we pretty much kept the same borders. So we've had our nations drawn for us. It's not that these nations have been put together by Africans. So that's why we had to build these nations, because they were given to us. So that's how we have to work. So we then have to start building nation states, and we use regional cooperation to strengthen the nation state. SADC used regional cooperation to protect nation states against apartheid South Africa, pretty much. That's how it was developed. We then use regional integration to drive industrialization rather than industrialization to drive regional economic integration. That's a complete reversal of what the Europeans were doing. We try to integrate economies without creating powers to the regional or continental level. So it's done on the basis of goodwill or on the basis of we think this is a good idea. And there's no sanctions on that. We use a top-down approach. We pronounce on time-bound targets, but leave it up to the members to determine how to reach the targets. And we don't domesticate, and we don't agree to have an integration by law. So it's a pretty fundamental difference that we have. So, the original question, SADC integration, are we getting there? Well, I would say, yes, we are getting there, but not in the way we expected or in the time that we expected. And the reason why I'm saying that is really integration will take place not because of what we're doing at the political level, but because of technology, population growth, and democracy. And those things are combining to lead to industrialization. I put industrialization in inverted commas, because it's not really industrialization as we know it now. It is more value addition and the new style of productivity. So SADC will have a regional integration driver similar to the European one, because I think that population combined with technology, combined with democracy, will force integration to take place. And so that we will make sure that that we're going to have that enabling environment in place. The reps are already there, so we can build on that and we can start to use that. So it's basically we have the mechanism now. We have the African Union, we have the recs, and they will then be able to be used to start to drive integration, but only if we have integration on the basis of law. Thank you, Chair.
Thank you, Mark, for a precise presentation, and also for reminding our MP or politician to you that we are short-term. Rachel, we have 20 minutes to...
Thank you. I'll be focusing on benefiting from the trade station agreement. From the outset, let me just say that given that I am from COMESA, my presentation will predominantly focus on what we're doing in COMESA. I think the discussant is from SADC, so hopefully in his response he'll be able to highlight maybe what SADC is doing, though Mark has already made some comments as well. Okay, first of all, I think the question that we're all asking when we're preparing our think pieces is why is the topic that we're discussing now important? And for the TFA agreement, historically we're all aware that it was finalized in December of 2013 by the WTO, and since that time it has undergone the legal review process, and we're at the stage now where member countries are meant to be ratifying the agreement. As you can see, we only have 8 countries at the moment that have ratified. But though that's a dismal number compared to the number of WTO members that are required for it to come into force, we do need 2/3 for the agreement to come into force. And I think going into Nairobi in December, there was an expectation for a bit more momentum on ratification, but at least the only thing that can encourage us as African countries is the fact that we have two Southern African countries that have ratified, namely Mauritius.
There might be some problems with the next microphone.
Oh, sorry. So as I was saying, the only consolation we have at the moment is that 2 African countries have been among the first 8, namely Mauritius and Botswana, that recently ratified in June. Sorry, I can't read the bottom half, so I'll just look at my laptop. So within COMESA, we are also trying, of course, to have our member states ratify the agreement. And at the moment, we have some, intel that Kenya, Swaziland have already begun their ratification processes. And we expect more of the member states, the COMESA member states, to follow. In SADC, I'm not aware of how many are in the process besides Swaziland that is both in COMESA and SADC. So just to give a brief sort of outline of what the TFA is about, for anybody that might not have had the chance to read it, it is broken down into 3 sections. The first section is really more about the technical measures, so what it is that member states will be required to do, and that is basically about 12 provisions. Then you have section 2, which is where you have your special and differential provisions. This is one of the things that has made it more unique as an agreement and why many of the developing and least developing countries have been able to embrace the agreement, is that it does take into consideration the capacity of member states to actually implement the obligations. And I think just to be clear that, of course, for those who are maybe might not be aware, the TFA is it's a mixture of binding provisions and best endeavors. So, of course, the encouragement is that member states should implement all the provisions, but it's understood that that will not be practically possible. So The best endeavors are there to, for those that can implement them, they will, and those that cannot will be allowed more time to do so. Oh, sorry, section three then covers institutional arrangements. Further going into the CFA, it provides for a three-tier process. So member states are really required to, that is developing, at least developing countries, are required to categorize their commitments into three categories. So category A are those that will be, are the provisions that countries can actually implement by the time the CFA comes into force. So these can be provisions that they are already implementing anyway, or that they expect to do so in the near future. Category B are those provisions that they will require some additional time after the TFA comes into force, but these do not require any extra support or financial assistance for them to implement. And then you have category C, which is probably the most critical for many of the COMESA and SADC countries, and those are the provisions that countries shall require technical assistance and capacity building in order to implement. So this is where the developing countries and development partners are instrumental to the implementation process. So I'll just go straight into the level of preparedness. Just here, sort of what we looked at, what I looked at was, you know, how many of the COMESA member states have even notified their category A, because that would seem like a straightforward process. But as Mark had already alluded, there was a need to undertake needs assessments to understand where countries are. So thus far, only five of our COMESA member states have notified. Of those five, if you compare what they have notified, those articles listed up there are where they have made notifications, but it's important to highlight that under each of those articles, member states have not notified the article in its entirety. So you'll have cases where they have notified maybe one third paragraph or two or three, depending on their capacity. So going into trade facilitation in COMESA, just to give a bit of a context, I hadn't wanted to talk about a lot about the COMESA FTA, but I think just to frame it better, I'll have to give a bit of a background. The COMESA FTA was launched in the year 2000, and at the moment we have 16 member states participating in the FTA. We expect the Democratic Republic of Congo to join the FTA, as has already been mentioned. We're similar to SADC in the sense that not all our 19 member states are actually party to the FTA. So we have another three member states that we're still waiting for, but DR Congo is expected in the near future. And that's a significantly large market for the region, so that will definitely have an impact on the volume of trade that's taking place within the region. And then also just to give an idea of the impact that the FTA has had, it was mentioned by colleague that in SADC's case, the FTA there's not been a huge difference before and after. With COMESA, I think we've seen significant progress. When the FTA was launched in the year 2000, intra-COMESA trade was at about 2 to 3 billion. As it stands now, it's at about 20.7. That figure is an approximate figure. So you can see there has been some significant progress. But even then, we are not where we should be in terms of intra-regional trade. So in that sense, you see that the TFA and also just general trade facilitation measures in the region are one of the factors that will contribute to the increase in intra-regional trade. As it stands now, we have an estimate of about the potential for trade within the region is about 96 billion. So if you compare that with the 20.7 or 21, if you round it off, where we stand now, we have a very long way to go. We could be doing so much more, and we could be performing much better. So we see the TFA and just other trade facilitation measures that COMESA has as a tool towards unlocking some of that potential. So now just to go into the legal context, the COMESA treaty has a variety of provisions that are targeted at trade facilitation. So from the outset, just to make it clear that for COMESA, trade facilitation is not a new thing. It's not a new phenomenon for us. It's something that has always been factored into the integration agenda. And it's something that actually I think in some ways COMESA has taken some bold steps. So in terms of being prepared for the TFA, I would say we are relatively well prepared. So just to give you an example, already Mark talked about the elimination of tariff barriers. We have a similar provision in our treaty. We have treaty provisions that talk about customs cooperation, and we have provisions that focus on the standardization and documentation, simplification of documentation. All those are already embedded within the TFA itself, so already there are some similarities within the legal framework that COMESA already has in place. And then we also actually have a specific article, which is Article 70, that speaks about trade facilitation purely, and that just calls on member states to implement programs collectively and cooperate. And thus far, I think, as COMESA, we have been making an effort to cooperate on trade facilitation issues. And then lastly, we do have three specific annexes to the treaty, and these are the protocol on transit trade and transit. And of course, this is pretty much related to the movement of goods in transit. And then we also have the protocol on third-party motor insurance, as well as the rules of origin. As it's already been debated, the difference between the COMESA rules of origin and the SAIIA rules of origin, I think our member states apply them with relative ease. We have some challenges here and there, but overall, on the whole, the rules of origin are working for the region. So, as I had already said, COMESA has been in the trade facilitation business for quite some time. These are just some of the few. We have quite a long list of whether you want to call them programs or interventions or instruments that are in place. So I've just picked out a few just to give you a broad idea of the different areas. And I think just from the outset to say that for COMESA, we have approached trade facilitation in a broader manner. I think it's not just about customs and borders and so forth. We have tried to really expand the reach of trade facilitation because we appreciate the role that it has to play in increasing interregional trade. So the first one, of course, is the elimination of non-tariff barriers. As Mark had already mentioned, this is probably one of the things that hinders intra-regional trade the most. And in COMESA, that's no exception. We have an online mechanism, and I'll have to admit that this mechanism was actually started under the tripartite. It's a tripartite initiative, but it's been embraced by the three RECs. At the moment, the system is still functioning, but is in need of some funding, and it's sort of in limbo. But while it was active and running, fully active and running, it has been very successful. So you have business persons who are able to report whatever NTBs they might be meeting along the way and in real time. So they as Mark said, you basically name and shame. And you do have member states willing to cooperate. In some instances, you'll find it's just a difference in interpretation of rules, whether they're rules of origin, whether they're fees at the border, and so forth. But about 80% of those for COMESA have been resolved. So the NTBs that we have are predominantly resolved within a reasonable amount of time. We have a few long-standing NTBs, but that is a different issue, and we as a secretariat are actively working with the member states to resolve them. So there are some that require a bit more effort and time and commitment from the member states to resolve. Already mentioned the COMESA rules of origin, those are in place. The protocol is functional and is being implemented. We also have the COMESA regulations on sanitary and phytosanitary measures. Again, here, as has already been mentioned, implementation is a challenge. But at least in terms of them being in existence, they are there, and our SPS unit is actively trying to promote their implementation at the member state level. Then I wanted to sort of highlight some of the more, unique interventions that COMESA has come up with. So we have the regional payments and settlement system. This is really a system that allows exporters and importers to make payments, but route their payments through the region, through regional banks. So at the moment, we have about, I got some information this morning, so that information down there has changed from the COMESA clearinghouse. But we have 8 countries that are now live on the system, and essentially it relies on the central banks within the member states acting as a guarantor of payment, and then that sort of streamlines the payment process, so you avoid having to route your money through an international financial center to make payments. At the moment, in terms of how well it's taking, it's still picking up. It's not yet fully functional. In the member states where the central banks have joined the system, you do have a need for more commercial banks to buy into it. But for those that are using it, they are finding it rather helpful. In terms of, it's significantly meant to reduce the cost of doing business for the SMEs, as somebody was talking about access to finance and making things less complicated. This system, if it was to be region-wide applied, you'd have your payments being processed maybe in 1 to 2 days, as opposed to the 3 to 5 or sometimes 7 working days that it takes to effect payments. So it would encourage, you know, businesses to use the system. So at the moment, we do have exporters using it and importers. But as I've said, it's still at the early stages. But it's one of our more promising initiatives. And we hope that member states will eventually take this up 100%. Okay, the one-stop border post have already been talked about. As you know, for Comesa, we have the wonderful problem of dual membership. So we have EAC member states, we have SADC member states, and then we have ourselves. So these are some of the border posts that we have operational. The most recent one that has been opened is between Uganda and Rwanda. Just to highlight the cost factor that was involved there is $7.8 million. That is a significant amount of money, which is why at the regional level, it's not an easy endeavor to implement, but the plan is to have more of the one-stop border posts across the region. We also have the COMESA virtual trade facilitation system, which is being piloted, and this is a cargo tracking system, so it's targeted at your transit goods and the trucks. This again is a new initiative. It's a passion project that our Secretary General strongly believes in and thinks will transform the way that transporters are doing business in the region, but this is still also at the early stages. And then lastly, I'll just talk about the simplified trade regime. And I think I'd like at this moment to link this back to a comment from Magda earlier on about women in trade. And this simplified trade regime, in simple terms, is targeted at small-scale traders, the majority of whom are women. And it's being implemented in Malawi as well, so if you want more information, we can share that. But this is something we would hope to roll out to more of the member states. It has worked relatively well at the borders that it's being implemented, and it just makes the process of trading much simpler. You have a simple customs document that they fill out, and there's a certain list of products that are agreed between two countries. And then those lists, whatever products that small-scale traders are carrying for those on the list, they are allowed to move across freely without too much hassle. And the gender aspect has been heavily input into this system, because we're aware of the harassment and the corruption and the bribery that women are facing, knowing that the majority of small-scale traders, about 70% if not more, are actually women. So this is something that is very, that we at the Secretariat and the member states as well are actually very passionate about. Okay, the potential for the impact. These are just some figures that I have borrowed from the OECD. They did a wonderfully long analysis and study about the impact of the TFA. The numbers literally do speak for themselves, so I'll just go straight to the end, really, the argument is made that the people who stand to benefit most from the TFA are the smaller, the low-income states. So a lot of our Southern African countries are in that category. So we stand to gain the most by implementing it. And I think one of the interesting things that they did with this analysis, they looked at a case of where if countries actually implement every single provision in the TFA, that is including the best endeavors, what the outcome will be. And if they just do partial implementation, which is only focusing on the binding provisions, what the outcome will be. So this will be shared later for you to have a look. I had wanted to talk about a little bit about the tripartite, but just in summary, I'll just say that the tripartite is essentially building on what's already in the regs. And I think the one thing that I can highlight about the tripartite is that in the course of negotiations, the WTO TFA was concluded, and the tripartite had already finalized and expired on customs cooperation. So there was a decision by member states to look at how we could bring in the TFA. So what the result of that was the development of Annex 6 on trade facilitation. And for all intents and purposes, it essentially borrows, I would say, 90% from the TFA. So everything in there is pretty much aligned. So in terms of implementation, you will not have a double layer of implementation. So that's the one thing I'll say about the tripartite. And then I think just to conclude is that for COMESA, we are trying to look at a regional approach to the TFA agreement. Of course, we already have our own programs, which are in some ways TFA plus. But we're hoping to, this is something that's still under discussion for member states to consider. They will agree on how they want to proceed, but we are, you know, trying to guide them towards, where possible, especially for category B and C, to align their notifications. So if we have a critical mass of member states notifying similar category C obligations, then what we can then do is package a regional implementation to those specific issues. And that will hopefully sort of reduce on the duplication. So you avoid a situation where, you know, Kenya goes and looks for funding to implement a category C, and then also Malawi is doing the same thing but the same provisions. So this is the approach we want our member states to consider, and hopefully they'll do that in September. We'll be having a trade and customs meeting, so that will be discussed in detail there. So that's the approach we want to take, and hopefully it will make implementation more seamless, and we'll capitalize on the resources available. We appreciate that donor funds are not in limitless supply, so by coming together, we hope to be able to tap into what is available and make the best use of it. So I'll end there. Thank you.
Thank you, Rachel, for an eloquent and optimistic presentation, highlighting some of the positive convergence structures that have been undertaken in COMESA. An optimistic presentation, and one that is realistic to my right, I would like to invite our discussant, Dura from SADC. Please, you have 6 minutes to sort of close some issues.
Thank you, Chair. Yes, I will take even less than that, otherwise our lunch will be in trouble. my presentation or input will be more focused on SADC regional integration process and also trade facilitation within the SADC region. But let me also mention that my views and inputs will be more not to do with the SADC Secretariat views. It's strictly mine. Mark talked about the SADC free trade area and also the challenges with regards to the SADC free trade area. Earlier on, Vinay had talked about the different milestones with regards to the SADC regional integration agenda. For example, we were supposed to achieve the FTA in 2008. 2010, we were supposed to achieve the customs union, which we didn't achieve, of course. Some of the speakers talked about, are we fully implementing the FTA? We recognize that a big player like DRC and also Angola, which is part of the SADC, is not part of the FTA. But we are glad that recently Seychelles joined the SADC free trade area, which is something to be applauded. But then all these milestones, it came from the RSDP, which is the Regional Indicative Strategic Development Plan, a plan that SADC had for 15 years, starting from 2005, which was supposed to go to 2020, and it was a long-term strategic direction as to how to integrate in terms of trade. So those milestones were enshrined in that strategic development plan. So being given that now the focus has changed and even the plans has been revised, that plan was done in 2003 for a long-term direction for 15 years. And then the plan was revised. Now we have a revised RSDP, the revised Regional Indicative Strategy Development Plan, which was approved in April 2015. But coming to the FTAs, yes, of course, we have challenges with regards to the implementation of the FTA. We still have two big players, like I mentioned, Angola and DRC, who are not yet party to the FTA. We are working on that one at SADC level. But of course, there are issues about enabling environment, which was also mentioned by Mark. Do we have that enabling environment? What about the review of the rules of origin? Are the rules of origin user-friendly? Are they like boosting trade within SADC? Are the enabling environment in terms of doing business within the South African borders, Southern African borders? Do we have those trade facilitation instruments? These are the enabling environment we were talking about. Then in 2010, of course, when we didn't achieve the customs union, this is where we started questioning about do we need the customs union? What do we do? Are we going to change the focus? And this is where SADC decided to put more focus on the consolidation of the free trade area, actually, instead of going for the customs union. How do we consolidate the free trade area? And this is where, how do we try to motivate DRC and Angola to come to join the free trade area? And also, we need to review the rules of origin, work on the implementation of customs and trade facilitation instruments. So these were some of the decisions which were taken by SADC in order to consolidate the SADC free trade area. Then coming to the review of the RISDP, I mentioned that in April 24, 2015, we had the revised RISDP, which was approved by the summit. And of course, the purpose and the scope of the RISDP has remained unchanged. We are still together with the RISDP, which was approved in 2003, as far as the objectives are concerned. But however, the alignment of priorities has changed, and the focus for SADC has changed. Today we have got more emphasis on some other priorities, including the priority A, which we have for SADC, is industrial development and market integration. We have got then the infrastructure development in support for regional integration. Then priority C, which is peace and security, and then priority D, which is other interventions in regional dimensions such as HIV and so on and so forth. So now the priorities have changed in SADC, and has already been approved by the summit already. The focus has to be on industrial development and market integration. When we talk about industrial development, what are the strategies? Here the focus will be more into enhancing industrial development, working on the regional value chains, the value additions which we all are talking about, then also consolidation of the free trade area, and trying to bring up an enabling environment which Mark mentioned about, and also trying to work on the, we talked about services, so we are also working on services at the SADC Secretariat level. Then when we talk about challenges in terms of reducing the cost of doing business, of course, Rachel talked about the WTO TFA. At SADC level, of course, we are also working on implementing the Trade Facilitation Agreement, but in line also with the SADC Protocol on Trade, we are already working on improving the cost of doing business. Let me share with you, out of the 15 member states that we have, 11 member states have already acceded and are already implementing the World Customs and Organization Revised Protocol Convention, which is already a great achievement. Then we have many initiatives going on within the Southern Africa. Let's say, for example, SADC, we didn't wait for the TFA to come to implement the single window. Single window has been implemented in Mozambique since 2009, even Madagascar, even Mauritius, we have the single window for logistics purposes. So these things we didn't wait for the TFA to come, it was already there, we were already working on those issues. Then when it comes to border management, we are working on, let's say for example, one stop border post. Chirundu is one of the brilliant example, the border post between Zimbabwe and Zambia. This is one of the best examples in the region that we have as a one-stop border post. Of course, we are trying to roll it out in other border posts also. Then we are working on, Mark referred to coordinated border management, also what South Africa has done in terms of bringing a legislation to create a border management agency. So all the member states within SADC are also thinking about implementing the coordinated border management. Last week I was in Namibia, we were launching the trade portal of Namibia. In the region for SADC, we have member states like Lesotho, Mauritius, Seychelles, who have already implemented the trade portals, which is a single, I think, click to get all trade-related regulatory information in the website. So we are also promoting such initiatives in the region. We are working towards the alignment of operating hours at the Secretariat. Also to do with SPS issues in the region. We have got an SPS strategy, and we also let me share with you finally that SADC in collaboration with USAID is actually from the directive of the ministers working on a comprehensive trade facilitation program, which will also take into consideration the WTO TFA. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you, Luna, for highlighting some of the activities that are currently being undertaken by SADC. I would like to open the floor for comments and questions. I'll invite for comments and questions, and if we still have time, maybe another two or three. Before we do that, I just wanted to probe Mark a bit. Your second last slide was quite fascinating because you compared the European Union model of trade integration to that of Africa. And then you concluded with a qualified yes. But when you look at the two models that you compared, one would say that Africa is really under stress, especially the model of Africa is under stress. But at the same time, when you look at the supranationalism of the European Union, it's also under stress. So where do we go to? What should be the inspiration? Because the European Union now with the crisis in Greece, and also the return, the forceful return of the nation state and national preferences with movements on the extreme left as well as extreme right rising. What does it tell us? What is the picture of regional integration and continent? And just to maybe to provoke Babajiti a bit here, at the AU, there is some people talk about regional economic communities as ordinarily they should be building blocks, but they are referred to as working blocks. How do we respond to that? Thank you. Four questions, please. Lee, Diapolo, and Dichapa. Roma. And Malawi. Okay, four questions and comments. Please keep your comments very brief. Yeah, please.
So thanks very much to the presenters. There are a couple of questions / observations I'd like us to consider. The one is whether that we should really think about the CFTA as a REC plus. Because unlike the EU, which Mark has robustly argued, African states don't really have a single legal compact. And the questions of compliance become much more difficult, and the questions of accountability become much more difficult. The other thing as well is that we seem to have major ambition, but we don't have the appropriate or underpinning policy and technical wherewithal and foundations to match our ambitions. In the realm of the CFTAs or the TFTA, even the SADC FTA. So the areas of trade remedy, dispute settlement, stimulants for industrialization, movement of people, competition policy, intellectual property, etc., in my mind, still do not necessarily advantage or enable small-scale industries, SMEs, to be vibrant. And to speak briefly to the point that Magda was making as well, for small-scale businesses. And the other thing is that central banks, what is their role in actually, and that's, I think, speaking to Rachel's point, is what is their role in promoting competitive exchange rates and also in controlling capital controls? Because these are some of the things and the confluences that cause economic disturbances and inconsistencies which can then disturb countries' ability to control and manage their social and development imperatives. And I don't think that it's per se appropriate to leave this entirely to vague and amorphous market forces. And as Mark said, the state is not a bad thing. And I think that we need to be able to control, put in place particular controls.
Thank you very much, Mr. Moderator. Let me also thank Mark and Rachel for those thought-provoking presentations. I want to refer to Mark's presentation about transportation, moving goods across borders, the fact that we have a number of fees and permits that we have to pay, and this raises the cost of business. But I want to extend that further to say that if you look at air transport, I think that's another sticky point. If you look at the cost of flying from Joburg to Gaborone, for instance, which is a very short distance, and you look at the cost of the ticket, I think about 50% of that is as taxes and levies. Yeah, 50%, taxes and levies. So that if you didn't have those levies, I think it would be cheaper to fly, and that will also promote services and integration. There are people who say that it's even cheaper to fly from Joburg to Cape Town, which is even further than Joburg to Gaborone. The fact that you have this artificial line, that border, makes such a huge difference. Thank you. I think this is one issue that is a low-hanging fruit that we could lobby for so that we abolish all the slaves. Thank you.
Yes, thank you, Mark and Rachel, for your very interesting and enlightening presentations. A couple of comments. First, on the integration process parallel between Europe and the region. Europe started in the 1948, memory serves well. So they had a long, 1950. So they had 50 to 60 years to do what we're trying to do in 10, 20 years. So I think we're moving well and we're doing a fairly okay job at the space that we're moving. So I think we might not be criticized, but we must probably see it in a positive way. Second, for us, Mauritius, I think SADC has been working very well. We want to speak from the private sector perspectives. 10 years ago, I'd say 2005, our exports to the region amounted to 5-6% of total exports, which was very low. And now it comes to about 20-21%. So over 10 years, we have increased our export to the region by a large amount. When Europe was in crisis, SADC was a market where we could turn to, especially for textile and clothing. At the moment, garments represent more than 60% of our exports to the region. SADC has also proved to be an interesting market for our domestic-oriented industries. What we have seen, those that we used to produce for the domestic markets, be it soap and detergents, animal feed, small product industries, small industries, have now started to look at the region. And when you look at the export figures, there's a wide range of products being exported to the region. So it has allowed us to diversify the range of products that export to the region. So in general for us, SADC is working very well. It's true that we would like to see some improvements in terms of the rules of origin, especially for textile and clothing, which we believe are stringent, more stringent than EPA, more stringent than AGOA. So we're trading among ourselves with more stringent rules than we're trading with other developed countries. So this is an anomaly that I think has to be reviewed. And probably flexible rules in the agro industry, because it's true that now raw material, the cost of production is the main thing that you look at in terms of competitiveness and of course cost of production. Third, eliminating of tariffs has not been the only thing inside it that has probably not allowed trade to take up as it should have been. Stats this morning. It's true that sometimes the cost of doing business in the region nullify with the effect of tariff reduction. And what we have heard from exporters is that it's more expensive to send goods to the region than to Europe. It takes longer to clear, it's more risky. So these things makes that it's not so easy to do business in the region. And these things cannot be addressed solely by having provisions in protocols. You know, unfortunately, those provisions stay there in the protocols and nothing happens on the ground to make things different. Maybe just to point out the ease of doing business published by the World Bank. And one of the main indexes there is the Trading Across the Borders Index, where most of us here have very bad ratings, around 100 above. So this shows that doing business in the region is not easy, and I would fully agree with Rachel that one of the ways to handle the issues that we face internally in the region in terms of logistics, in terms of documentation, in terms of cost, in terms of procedures, would be to start working on the, I think, implementation of the trade facilitation agreement. But that could just be one of it. So how to address the other things than tariffs would be for us one of the priorities for the region in the coming years. Thank you.
I would like to thank you, Senators Mark and Commissar, for their presentation. Mine is April from the organizations which are around here. Malawi is a landlocked country. Our cost, over 60% goes to transport. So I would like to urge the organizers of this meeting, UNESA and the SADC, to do studies. Studies were already done by African Union and the Commonwealth Secretary about the transportation cost and the dual membership, which Malawi falls, UNESA and the SADC. And the documentations we made, but we haven't implemented the recommendations. We are doing the trade facilitation projects which are embarked by COMESA and SADC. But my plea is for the organizers of the meeting, COMESA and SADC, to do studies on the transportation cost, because that's our weakness, because Malawi is a landlocked country. Thank you very much.
Obviously, one of the important elements in the ultimate regarding trade facilitation is that ability to reduce the cost of doing business. Now, I have seen that a number of times references are made to what the World Bank says about this cost. I'm not sure what the RECs will do in dealing with the measurement for the ultimate implementation and achievement. But what sometimes worries me is now that some of the countries are deeply landlocked. And if you look at a country like Lesotho and you look at the World Bank measurements, they start counting the number of days for clearance from Durban, from the Durban port. Now the question is, because once you mention something in a report, investors are looking and they will want to say, should we invest in that country? And the question is, if you report 31 days of clearance, will Lesotho ever get rid of that? Because part of that is out of their control. So I'm just trying to ask a question of whether is some of these elements, are they really helping us? Or they could actually maybe create more problems for us. So maybe that is what the other element that we could also need to look at to say, how are we putting the targets? Because I mean, we all want every one of these countries to achieve something and to fully get to what is needed. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Just very quickly, I think first of all, I think we should understand. I think Richard and Mark alluded to that point, that the SADC integration experience is not necessarily representative of the integration experience across the continent. I think the point raised by the colleague from Malawi and even Lesotho about landlocked and transport costs, all you have to do is look at the case of EAC, the East African Community. And you know, it's not as if Rwanda or Uganda are less landlocked than some of the landlocked countries that we have in Southern Africa. How have they been able to achieve the kind of results that they have achieved, even though, you know, notionally it's the same standard which they use to judge Lesotho with, when it has to do with the Durban port that is used to assess its countries. And the answer has been deeper integration, not less integration. Because as part of the customs union, then they are able to have a legal framework which they can use to address Kenyan ports regulations or Tanzanian port regulations, which then affects their own bottom line at the end of the day. So perhaps I think it's very important for SADC not to just look inward, but then to look at the entire African experience and see what you can learn in terms of what has worked in these countries and how that can work for SADC. And then the second, which is more of a question, I think in a lot of the discussions with SADC, you know, there's what my colleague alluded to about industrialization focus, and I've never been quite able to understand it, because from my point, it looks to be impossible to have a common industrial policy without having a common trade policy first. And then if you say you want to hold off on trade integration so that you can focus on industrial development, then on what basis really would you be able to actually have common policy measures to do industrial policy or to support industry? So perhaps if someone can clarify that divergence between, you know, what you say you want to do and exactly how you will do it without deeper trade integration.
Yeah. Rachel, please take some of the comments and questions, and then we'll go to Mark.
Okay, I'll start with, I think there were only about two questions directed at me. The one about the role of the central bank. I'm not from a central bank. I don't know how much control. Was it on exchange rates or interest rates? Both. Only exchange rates. Okay. I think central banks within the economists will have to support me here, have a limited role in what they can do in terms of interfering with the markets. I'm Ugandan, so I'll give an example of recently. We were having challenges with our exchange rate, and the central bank intervened, but only to a certain extent. So I think in that case, I don't know if that dynamic is ever going to be drastically changed. That's that. Then about the transport costs and dealing with dual ownership, what can be done? The studies, I think, have been done. I don't know if COMESA undertook a study. If we haven't, I'm sure we probably have. I have my transport colleagues who work on this day in, day out. And transport costs are, of course, a big factor, and we understand it. And that's why a lot of our initiatives are also targeting the transport issues. But I think, and let me not be crucified for saying this, but the transport issue is not just about the legal framework and having the right policies in place. A lot of these things are in place. The challenge now comes down at a private sector level, because you cannot make transport companies reduce costs, even if you know that you have put in place certain measures for them to maybe, you know, gradually reduce those costs. So that is something that I think for any companies that are in business, you wonder why those costs are not transmitted to the consumer. When I say the consumer, I mean both the final consumer products and also you as a private sector company that is using the transporting companies. Within COMESA, we have an understanding, well, we like to call it that they're really cartels, for lack of a better word. They really are just cartels operating in terms of the transport issue, because they're aware that countries are, we're literally at their mercy. So there, it's an interesting dynamic. But of course, as a secretariat and as member states, you can try as hard as you can, and we will continue to do so. But there's another dimension that really is somewhere outside the realm of a secretariat or even of a member state, say for looking at competitiveness issues, or maybe raising a case in terms of competition policy. But that's a different matter. So that's that. But in terms of the studies, we will definitely take that on. And if there's something that we can discover that can guide us in how we can address those issues, then we will. And then lastly, I think Jude took the words out of my mouth. In terms of for Lesotho's case and those that are landlocked, the reality is you'll never run away from that. But the idea is that if your member, your partner countries who are your access points can do something about the delays. And that is why, like you said, EAC is a wonderful example. They have Dar es Salaam is being reformed, and so is Mombasa. And those effects should trickle down to the landlocked countries. So that is the idea, because there is no other way to go about it. So if the port countries can work on their issues, and that can be done at a regional level, because then that way you drive it from a regional perspective, and hopefully it will trickle down to the landlocked. But that's it.
Thank you very much for the questions. I think some of them are linked together, so excuse me, I'll put them together. The first one is the CFTA is a direct plus. I think it's an interesting question and really looks at where we should start from in doing the continental FTA. There are some people who think that it's a mistake to start with saying we're going to get to an FTA instead of saying we want to get some building blocks that will make up an FTA and work towards that. So you take the pressure off the countries. You don't say, okay, we're going to get to an FTA by 2017, but we are going to start off with trade facilitation, with dispute settlement, with the tariff phase down, with all of these various blocks of an FTA, and then build up to the situation where you can get an FTA, rather than say, we do an FTA, and then you've got to do all of these things in place. So that, the way that we're doing it is the other way around. The way the CFTA is being done is modelled very much on the way that the TFTA is being modelled, and hopefully the CFTA process will learn from the mistakes that were made in the TFTA and not repeat those mistakes. The ambition, it's a major ambition, but we don't have the mechanisms and instruments to reach this. Yeah, I think that's true, but I don't think we should reduce the ambition. We should maybe lower our time expectations. I mean, it does take time, and it does take money to build those instruments and mechanisms. And not only that, you have to have quite robust governance structures in the national states before you can start building at the regional level. So you can't be looking at having a competition policy at a regional level when you don't have a competition policy that works at a national level. So those are issues which need to be addressed as well. The central banks, as Rachel says, central banks have got limited control. I mean, at best they have control over monetary policy, where actually the exchange rate depends very much on borrowing requirements and borrowing policies of government. And when you have pressure on the currency, it's often to do with the exchange control, the capital accounts and the current accounts, which are mainly the Ministry of Finance that deal with that. The transport fees and air transport, I think that's a very good point. I would say that if we had all implemented the Yamoussoukro agreement and had free skies, then we would have a lot more competition, and we wouldn't have cartels, and we wouldn't have situations where one airline can keep on raising the fees and not being able to do anything about it. I think there are also issues in terms of high costs, but for example, if you have a situation where you have a fuel levy placed on it because the cost of fuel is $100 a barrel, now it goes to $50 a barrel, you still pay as if it's $100 a barrel. There's no real understanding in my mind of that. We've had the Europeans have 50, 60 years to do what we're trying to do in 10 years. I certainly agree that
the expectations are quite high in terms of the time limits that we have. When the tripartite FTA was launched, the discussion was about how long it would take us to get there, whether 5 years or 3 years. Now, the point is, no one had actually done any calculations on the 5 years or the 3 years. They just said, no, 5 years is good, we can do it in 5 years. No, we do it in 3 years. So it's maybe over-ambitious in that respect. But I would say that continental integration in Africa is about as old as independence is, which is now 50 years as well. So I think there are those. Exports from Mauritius have grown. I think that's very true, and I'm absolutely not saying that that regional integration is useless. Those of you who think I'd say that obviously don't know me very well. But what I'm saying is that we need to understand what the issues are if we're going to improve it. For example, if you talk about exports from Mauritius in textiles and clothing have increased, that is probably because, despite the fact that you have the SAIIA trade protocol in place, because you have a double transformation rule of origin. So it's hard to get origin conference because of the double transformation. So it's not necessarily the case that exports have grown because of the trade liberalization that's in place. It may be despite of that, and I'm also just saying that I'm not saying that the trade has not increased under SADC and the trade protocol. And I certainly want to qualify that. I'm talking about percentages, not absolutes, whereas Rachel was talking about absolutes. I'm definitely, economies have grown, so obviously they're going to have increases. But I think that really it's a question of improving on what we have. It's definitely not a question of saying what we're doing is useless. It's saying, let us try and see where the challenges are and be realistic in addressing those challenges. Let's not be afraid of doing that. The costs of inter-regional trade are more than Europe. Yeah, they are. And the ease of doing business ratings, that's an interesting point and comes back to what you were saying. When you look at the World Bank calculations on ease of doing business, what they do is they calculate a linear progression. So they say it takes this amount of days to raise a letter of credit. It takes this amount of days to pack a container. It takes this amount of days to secure a transporter. And then they add it all up as if you have to wait to do your letter of credit first, and then you go look for an exporter, and then you go and do this, then you go and do this. And at the end of the day, you have 60 days. It's not linear. No exporter does that. So it is a major issue. And also, it's not scientific in the way that they do that. They say, how long does it take you as an exporter to get there? And the guy says, hey, I have real problems. My goods were at customs for 20 days. Well, they might have been at customs for 20 days because he hadn't paid his duties. That's why, not because it takes 20 days to clear it. So I think that the ease of doing business calculations are useful if you're trying to compare two countries. That's all. It's a comparative indicator. It should not be used as an absolute. Landlocked countries, over 60% goes to transport. I personally feel that we've done enough studies. We're beyond studies. I can tell you, in Malawi, one of the reasons why it costs so much money is, one, because you have very few transporters, and two, because you can only have 48 tons because of the bridge that goes across the Limpopo at the Zambezi in Mozambique. So you can only take 48 tons. You don't have backloads, so you send your cotton and everything down. There's no backloads. So there's a lot of issues that need to be addressed practically, rather than just looking at studies on those things. Abidjan's issue in terms of the integration and we learn from other regions, absolutely. But I do think that the fundamentals are the same, that we have the same system of integration. We have the same, we don't have a rules-based system. We have a top-down system, and that is right the way through from all the way through. And just as an aside, in EAC, it still takes 18 days to move a container from Mombasa to Nairobi, 480 kilometers.
thank you very much to our two presenters and our discussant. I'd like you to join me in thanking them for brilliant presentations and also robust responses from the floor. Thank you very much. There is indeed a light at the end of the tunnel, and it's not the dream. Before we break for lunch, a few announcements. Well, the first one is that we have to take a group photo outside before we proceed to lunch. And we will reconvene at 2. If for those of you who are in need of parking vouchers, please consult with Juanita, as well as Matt, I have to confirm dinner with Juanita as well. That's for those of you who are attending a dinner this evening. Thank you. Enjoy your lunch. Bon appétit.